Hello, everybody. How are you doing? I hope you can hear me okay. If you can see and you can hear me okay, let me know in the chats. Just started a few minutes early. Got everything set up, all my materials and stuff like that. And I'd just like to welcome you to the workshop today. For those of you who are new, my name is Darren Yu. I am an artist based in Melbourne, Victoria. And I run a bunch of these watercolor workshops. I teach watercolor here, and it's been good. I've been doing this for quite some time now. So thank you all for joining. It's going to be a really great session today. We're going to do a scene of Barmouth in Wales. I actually had to look up where this place was from, because I downloaded this photo probably about 3 or 4 months ago. And as you know, as you're going through your reference photos, you're always trying to find, geez, what am I going to paint? It's easy to find reference photos, but then to pick one, that's difficult. Well, for me anyway. So let me know how you're doing and where you're watching from in the comments. I'm going to check. I've got another computer on the right-hand side, so you might see me sort of shifting off the camera here and there. It's just so that I can see the chats. And I've really missed doing these sessions. It's been a little while, but I've been working on my website and just been busy with a few other things. So, but I have missed seeing you guys and running some of these. So it's really good to be back. So we've got Margaret McFadden. How are you doing, Margaret? Thank you for joining. I think Anne as well. Anne Holden says, yes, can hear you fine on Facebook. Excellent. Yvette, good to see you, Yvette. Yvette's been a long time watcher. Same with Margaret and Anne as well. I think Yvonne's here as well. Yvonne says, having some internet connections. Okay, fantastic. I hope you're, if you watch along for a little bit, you can also change the quality of the stream on the bottom right-hand corner of the video. There's a little cog and you can click that and change it to another stream quality. Sometimes it could be your internet. So definitely give that a try. I'm just having a look at I'm having a bit of an issue with the comments this morning, because for some reason they're just showing up all over the place. I've got three different screens open. So if I end up missing your comments, guys, I apologize, but I'll just be looking out mainly for the questions and just trying my best to look through. So we've also got Marion. Yeah, you're going, Marion. And Marion was you were messaging me before, I think, about the reference. Remember you. We've also got Holly. Holly Carlo is asking, we'll be able to watch this again later. Yeah, it's available afterward. But I like to just have people in the live. It's good. It's good motivation for me as well. I don't want to be talking to myself. So thank you for coming along. Renee's asking, is there a supply list? I know it's late, but I still have to retrieve them. Yeah, I sent out the list through email. So if you check your emails, it should be there. But basically today, what I'm going to be using is just some normal watercolor paints. As long as you've got your primary colors, you've got a blue, you've got a yellow, and you've got a red, that should be fine. Okay, I do use a few others as well. But basically your primary colors you can get by. Often people buy sets of 20 watercolors, that kind of thing, but it's not really necessary. You need a few to really get through a nice painting. I'm also going to be drawing in pen today. It's just a bit easier for you guys to see. You know, when I sketch in pencil, often people say it's difficult to see what's going on. Pencil is just a bit lighter, and also, you know, drawing in pen just has a slightly different style. So it's kind of a line and wash style where you can still see the pen show through. But if you guys don't have any black pens, or you prefer doing it in just normal pencil, go ahead and just use pencil. It will look kind of similar, except the outlines of the objects will not appear as visible. So when you draw in pen, what will happen, because watercolor is a transparent medium, it's just going to leave a light layer of color over the top, but underneath you should still be able to see the pen. So it's really just a stylistic thing, guys. So I'm just giving a little bit of time for people to start coming through in the live. And looks like we've got about, geez, how many we've got? Maybe nearly 70 people on YouTube. And let's have a look. Yeah, about maybe 60, 70 people at the moment. Fantastic. So I will be starting soon. But if you have any questions, just, yeah, definitely just pop them in the chats. I will get back to you. And, you know, if I'm, you know, because I'm here, I think just ask away, ask any question. There's no such thing as a silly question, especially if you're, you know, it doesn't matter how long you've been painting for. So I'm here to help you out. So just drop into the chats and I'll do my best to get back to you. So I think my hair's sort of sticking up a bit everywhere, but you know, for me here, it's not too early in the morning, but it's 10 a.m. in the morning. I think for those of you guys in the States, it'd be 6 p.m. I had to convert the time into the US time. Laura's saying, can't hear anything. I'll try to reconnect. Laura, sometimes what happens is that the video will be, the video will be muted automatically. So if you go down to the bottom right-hand corner, there's a little speaker symbol. And if you click that, it should enable the audio. So give that a try, Laura. Hopefully that works for you. Margaret says, looking forward to the class. Fantastic. And Katie says, really enjoy the video on perspective. Fantastic. Yeah, I made a couple of those videos, so I emailed them out as well. Now, I did a little, like a 5-minute sketch of this scene before I started today. And I love doing little sketches because there's not much pressure to get anything right. And it allows you to compose your scene. So rather than aiming for accuracy, I sort of look at, what can I change up in the scene to make it look more interesting? Now there's boats and stuff like that here, but I thought it's just missing a bit of life. I want to put in some people. So I've added in some people, try to exaggerate some of these shadows a little bit like that. So I think this is a kind of a decent composition to go by. One of the things to keep in mind as well is a lot of people, and thank you so much for filling in the surveys, because I asked for a couple of surveys for you guys to help me fill in those, and I got some good ideas there as to what you guys want to see. And the main things you want to talk about was layering, perspective, how to add depth to your painting, composition and drawing. So, you know, I think this will be good because we're going to cover all those topics. So drawing, composition, a bit of perspective as well. I'll talk a bit about that. And then in terms of getting in depth and just a feeling of a sort of 3D, a 3D feeling in your painting. I'll go through that layer later with the layering, how to get in all the light colors and the dark colors, how to make objects appear further back in the distance and closer as well. You know, that's part of perspective, and it's also part of watercolors because you're going to need to control your tone. Tone is basically how light or how dark a certain area is. Normally, when you're looking at things out the back, in a landscape scene like this, the background objects are going to appear lighter, less detailed, sometimes have furry kind of edges, okay? And they'll often appear with a slight bluish tint. If you look at those, I think the mountains in the reference picture right at the back, they kind of take on a bluish tinge, whereas you go a little bit forward, things appear to be more in contrast and more saturated in color. So, and if you look at the foreground as well, certainly a lot more detail here. But again, the reference picture versus reality. In reference photos, sometimes the photographers will use editing software, will change things up, exaggerate bits and pieces. Okay, so really recommend you guys to sketch a lot. Use a pen or use a pencil, do a quick sketch, and give yourself a time limit. Say 5-10 minutes, I'm going to do a quick sketch. And it's amazing how much you learn from it. Now, the perspective of this scene, you'll notice that the horizon line is basically the point right at the back where all the objects disappear. It's kind of represents infinity, okay? So it's kind of just behind those mountains, okay? Right around about there where the houses are. So if you notice, it's quite high up. The horizon line's all the way up here. So when you've got a horizon line that's further up, it makes it appear as if your vantage point is from a higher up location. So we're actually looking down onto this scene of boats and people. And it's kind of like, it's not really a bird's eye view, but it's a higher vantage point. And so that's why we've got this sort of scene here. And the heads of the figures are also below the horizon line, as you can see. Okay. Normally I do a lot of street scenes and stuff like that. Here's an example, just a quick one I did the other day. Horizon line is about here, and the heads of the figures are around here. So it's a very flat sort of vantage point, just looking straight on a flat plane, whereas this one here, we're looking down onto a scene, so the horizon line's further up and the figures, the heads, are further down. Okay, so really quick sort of thing. I mean, I've also done a pure watercolor version of this scene. I'll just show you. This was another street scene I did. Again, perspective wise, you can see the horizon lines cut somewhere in the back there, where all the objects just disappear into the distance. Usually it's at the bottom of the buildings at the back. Okay, and I put the heads of the figures on the horizon line, roughly around the horizon line. Makes it look like there's a flat plane, which is sort of the same height as these figures looking forward. Okay, it's one of the biggest questions people get in the beginning and struggle with. They tend to put objects and figures all over the place, too high, too low, okay, that kind of thing. This is a one I did the other day of the scene just in pure watercolor, so we'll be doing something a little bit different. Donna's talking about audio, so yeah, check. Fantastic. Yeah, thank you, Katie. Katie's just asking about just gave a tip about the audio. If you can't hear anything, bottom right hand corner, let's just write it in the chats as well. Okay, fantastic, good. So yeah, let's have a look. Lisa's asking, shall we trace your sketch? You can trace if you want to, Lisa. You can trace, you can draw along with me. I'm gonna draw this whole thing again. So if you want to trace it, that's fine. This was like a quick one I did like a few minutes. So by just trying to give you a little rundown of sketching, the importance of it. Okay. Is anyone else having an issue with the audio? I think we all are okay. Okay, Donna says got it. Fantastic. Don't want to leave anyone out. So I think we've got everyone here. Okay, so I am actually gonna start now. But if you have any questions throughout the session, let me know. And one last thing, would you guys be okay if we finish? You know, if we go through the whole scene and you end up with a beautiful painting, would you mind if I talk a little bit about a workshop I have running next week? Let me know if it's cool with you guys. Don't want to focus too much on that at the moment, but let me know if that's okay. I just want to talk a bit about a workshop that I have running. Okay, and there's a few questions as well. Peggy's asking, what size watercolor paper? So you can use whatever size you want. I'm using A4 size, which I think is, I always have to convert this. I think it's 10, let me have a look. I don't know what it'd be in inches. 11.5 inches by 8 inches. So you can use a sheet like this. You can go larger, you can go smaller. It just really depends. I think I go one around this size so that it allows me to get in just enough details. If I go too small, then I'll just be drawing and it becomes too cramped. If I go too large, if I go A3 with one of these scenes, usually with a large sheet of paper, you need to put more details in there. Okay, so I always try to, with these particular scenes, match up. Okay, have a look at the scene and think to yourself, okay, do I want it to be really detailed? Do I want a lot of stuff going on in there? If there's a lot of stuff going on in there, sometimes it's better if you use a larger bit of paper rather than trying to cram in all that detail into a little square and miss the point. So sometimes as well, you might have a scene that's got lots of detail. I mean, in this scene actually, there's quite a lot of detail. And we've got a smaller bit of paper, so I'll actually try to reduce the amount of detail. I'm not going to put in all of these boats in there. I haven't counted them all, but I'm pretty sure there's probably 20 plus boats in there. So, you know, things like that, because on a smaller bit of paper, too much can look overwhelming at times. So I hope that answers your question. And good to see you. Good to see you, Neil. Thank you for coming along and fantastic. Alrighty. Any more questions, guys? Otherwise, I'm going to get started. Renee's asking, cold press or watercolor texture? Cold press, which is kind of like a slightly textured paper, is what I'm using here. Okay, so it's basically It's basically, you have smooth watercolor paper, you've got cold press or medium textured, or you have rough paper. Usually I use cold press most of the time, especially with landscapes. The reason why is because smooth watercolor paper is suited mainly, in my opinion, to things like portraits. This is a portrait I did the other day, and you're able to get in a lot of detail with smooth watercolor paper, but you get these kind of furry edges and kind of blooms and stuff like that. So that can be an issue with landscapes. So usually with landscapes, I tend to use paper that's slightly textured. Here as well, you can see it's all textured paper and it blends together nice. So you get a nice holistic sort of feeling through the scene, okay? Donna's asking, did you already send the color list? Yeah, I did email it out. But I know there's been some issues with people maybe not receiving emails and stuff like that. But Donna, if you've got your yellow, you've got a yellow, you've got a blue, and you've got a red, that's fine, okay? That's all you need. I do have a few other colors in here, but make do with what you have. In fact, as a beginner, if you use less colors, you're going to be far better off. One of the big mistakes I think beginners make is that they buy those big palettes with 20 colors in it and they try to use it all, and it's very difficult to achieve color harmony. And when I talk about color harmony, I'm talking about the balance between the cool colors and the warm colors. And we've got all these different colors going around, it can just look a bit overwhelming. They mix together and you end up creating a lot of order kind of muddiness in there. So I'd recommend just using as few colors as you can, guys. If you stick to yellow, red, and blue. That's mainly the ones I use. I just use different, slightly different blues. I might use a cerulean blue, which is a lighter blue, and then an ultramarine blue. And I might use a hansa yellow, which is like a vibrant yellow, and a yellow ochre, which is a very muted kind of yellow. Okay, so fantastic. Thank you, Katie, for pasting in the materials. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and get started. Now, I have got a whole bunch of pens here. Now, I've got, this is a bit, I'm overdoing it. I've got too many pens, but if you just got a normal black pen or you just got a normal pencil, just use a pencil. Okay, I'm going to use pen so that you guys can see a bit better as to what I'm actually doing. I think this is a 0.5. Okay. So with your bit of paper, what I want to do first, I'm just going to go around and just create a border, just a rectangular border around here. Now I'm just doing this to make sure the paint doesn't go over into the next page. With that said, I mean, I have other ones that I've done and all the way to the edge like that. But the framing effect also is quite interesting. It gives it a slightly rougher look. And even if you go outside the frame, it actually looks quite nice. So just going to go here, just quick, you know, like that. All freehand, guys. You notice when I draw lines as well, I don't try to draw that line all in one go. I kind of just pick up the pen and draw it in little parts. Okay, like that. So don't feel like you've got to draw that line all the way. Down. Okay. Now the easiest thing to start off with, I always look at when I start doing a painting or a drawing or line and wash scene, we want to look at what's the most simplest way to divide this landscape. And in this scene, it's basically the horizon line. So what I was talking about before, the line right at the back, where everything disappears off into the distant mountains. Okay. And it's kind of just underneath where the mountains and stuff like that. So if you look at where that bridge is, there's a bridge around here that's slightly above the halfway point of the page, okay, of the reference photo. You've got halfway through the reference photo, a little bit up, that's where the bridge is. I'd say the horizon line is somewhere around here, okay, so just above the halfway point, okay. And look, it's not necessary to get it in 100% accurate, okay, just get that horizon line a little bit higher than usual, something like that. And if it's not in the right place later, you can always move it a little bit, but I like to just put in a quick indication like that. Okay. What else have we got? What's the next easiest thing we can do? Well, of course, we've got these mountains that we can drop in there. We've also got this area down the front where there's boats and things like that. So I'm just going to scratch in a few little, not even a proper line, but just a quick little bit here to indicate where the water kind of meets the sand, somewhere like here. Okay. No, and I also, when I draw, I sometimes use the edge of the pen to just scratch in a little bit of ink in there, but not make it too obvious. If you're using a pencil, it's going to be a lot easier for you. But when you're using an ink pen, this is what happens. Okay. So depending on which one you're using. So let me know again, if you have any questions, drop it in the chats while I'm here. We've also got, we've got a few chats on YouTube. We've got Don, good to see you, Don. It's been a while, and Don's part of an urban sketching group, and I think he does a lot of these actually. So good to see you. And we've got Jill. I think that's Jill. Ah, sent me an email. Sent me an email last night about the workshop. Thank you for joining, Jill, from Venice Beach, California. We've got Susan Bass. They're so excited. Thank you. You've got Pamela Meredith. Good to see you, Pamela. Pamela is part of one of my other programs. So thank you for joining, Pamela. I've also got Ellen. Good to see you, Ellen. Good to see a few familiar faces. I've missed chatting to you guys and doing these. So yeah. Anyway, back to this. So we've got 2 points in. Horizon line. We've got a bit of a line here, a tiny bit of a line at the bottom. Basically that just separates the sand from the water. And then the sand is a reddish, really dark yellow kind of color at the bottom. So I want to lighten that up, make it a bit brighter, kind of like the sand at the back. And these here as well. Good to see you. I haven't seen you for a while. So thank you for joining. And, Hope you've been feeling better since last time. I know you've had some issues with your back. So good to see you. And are you back painting today, or are you just watching? Okay. Don says it's been a long time and been able to join in. Missed it a lot. Yeah, I appreciate it, guys. Sometimes it's just great to do these. Lucia, good to see you, Lucia, as well. All right. Get back to the drawing. Now, we've got the two most simple things in. The next part, really, it's just up to you. I mean, I might even start putting in the mountains, kind of like here. Okay, I've gone up a bit far. When you make a mistake like that, especially if you're drawing in pen, don't worry about it. Just continue on, yeah? Just continue on. I'm just going to place in general location of the mountains. And we look at where they finish. It kind of finishes about here, about 3/4 of the way through the page. It's larger kind of mountain shape as well. Kind of finishes like here. And then we've got another one that just sort of goes up there, goes off into the distance to the right-hand side. Okay. So we've got some mountains back there. Okay. So we've got mountains. We've got the water. We've got the land. That's the, in my opinion, I think that's the hardest bit out the way. If you can get these elements in correctly, in terms of you want to leave some sky. Sometimes people might do the mountains too big and they'll draw the mountains up here and leave like a little bit of sky. We want to make sure we've got sky. So sky, land, in this case it's water. So sky, water, and a bit of the land here. Looking at the reference picture, observing where the water starts in the reference, around about maybe halfway point going towards the right. I've actually drawn my horizon line a little bit higher than the reference photo, but you know, again, it doesn't make a huge difference if you're a little bit off. You at the end of the day, you're composing a scene, and you can even lower that horizon line to make it more eye level. You can raise it more to make it appear like you're higher up. You know, photographers do it when they're taking a photograph. So obviously, like, we can do that as well when we're composing our painting and our scene. So I'm going to go in and just draw a bit of this boat. Now, look at objects when you're drawing them, and instead of looking at it as a boat, look at it as how can you break it down into something simple? Okay, this boat kind of starts across here, and it's got a pointed front like that, and then you've got the back, which is like this. OK, it's kind of like a rectangle, like this. Okay, and I'm being pretty quick with this one as well. There we go, a bit of that underneath part of the boat there. Okay, and then on top of the boat, we might have like this top section of it like that. Okay, that kind of teal color, that beautiful teal colored area like this. Maybe some bits and pieces on the front of it here. Okay, let's have a look. There's a little bit of that coming off. The important thing is this shadow. You'll notice there's a kind of really dark shadow underneath underneath the yacht. So we'll have to actually get in a bit of detail there for it. But I'm going to use another pen and get in some of that afterwards. Okay. Bit here. Let's just get in a bit more of this side like that. There. Okay. That so I'm looking at the, it's kind of like, it's almost a rectangular shape, rectangular sort of shape for the sides for the boat. On the top of it we've got perhaps a bit of this here like that, there. Okay, don't worry all too much about the details, focus mainly on the basic shape. You can even start putting in the what do you call it? The mast, like this. You know, this one's down, but I might actually make it go further up, like as it's up, like this. Okay, I don't know how far I'll make it. Something like that. I'll redo it later. That. Okay. Fantastic. I'm guessing you guys are. Guessing you guys are pretty busy. Linda says the video keeps freezing. Okay, I think I am back. Apologies guys, I don't know what happened, but my stream just cut out. I've reset everything. It's been a while since I've been streaming, so as just so happens that things go wrong just when you need them to go right. But you know, look, good to see that most of you are still around. I hope you can hear me. Let me know in the chats if let me know in the chats if you can hear okay. The stream quality seems good to me. I'm just looking at the stats in the video. So it seems to be good, guys. So Maggie says I can hear and see you on YouTube. And I think Lucia says all good for now. Give it a little bit. If it's frozen, just give it a little bit. I think it should be okay in a moment because I've just reconnected. I think what happened was that my my internet switched over to the Wi-Fi. I have another connection, and it for some reason it just got confused. So yes, Laura's asking, you're streaming YouTube? So yes, I am streaming YouTube. So I'm kind of doing a couple at the same, two different streams at the same time. So sometimes this happens. I just didn't expect that to happen today. But it's good to see you guys are still here, and. Had a bit of a heart attack, but I think we're all good for now. All right, let's hope that it doesn't cut out again. But if it does cut out again, just hang in there. I don't think it will. I don't think we'll have issues though. All right, so we're up to drawing these boats. So I've only at this point used one pen, and that's all you need. I do have some other kind of specialty pens, which are kind of like a flat liner sort of pen. And you know, you'll notice in here, you've got like these little kind of these little slits here for the windows. So I sometimes just like to use this little pen here to draw it in. But if you do have a normal liner like this, just draw it in. You can just take a little bit longer to do it. And with the boats as well, sometimes I like to just change it up. I might put a bit of something coming off on this side like that. Okay. Maybe add in a bit of color. Let's put in another one. So we've got one here, Somewhere in the water, something like this. Keep in mind as well, as we go further back into the distance, that they're going to get smaller, okay, as we go back into the distance. So this one is going to be slightly smaller, but really not too much of a difference. Okay, there you go. Just a quick little indication like that. Now, there is also, let me have a look, also some more boats on the right-hand side that we can go for. We can go this one here. Let's do this boat. Now, it's kind of a interesting looking one. I'm going to simplify it down like this. Okay, just go like that. There, down, like that. It's kind of like a large, it looks like quite a larger boat, actually. There. Then I'm just going to put in a little bit of detail here. Yeah, just little indications of what's in there, or just little shapes. Okay, when you draw anything, try to simplify it down to shape. Just looks like a rectangle at the bottom with a kind of sharper edge at the front of the boat, and then over here you've got the mast sort of going up all the way like that. That's another one. Fantastic. You know, another thing to put in here is that you might think we could put in some figures and stuff, but let's leave the figures and let's continue putting in some boats. And it's up to you. You can choose. This might be enough for you. You might be okay with that. But I'd suggest put in a few little ones in the background. And what that will do is make it look like we'll create that sense of depth. No, one of the things you guys were asking about, how do you sort of create that sense of depth, make it look like you've got a receding sort of a distance, especially in perspective. And if you look at that house looks up in the hills. That enormous house looks quite tiny. If we compare the size of that house to that boat, they look the same size. That's because it's further back. Okay, so everything in the background, just make it a little bit smaller. Now, I hope you, I think some people are having issues with that's okay. I think you guys are all able to see it and things like that now. Just double checking the stream. Getting a bit paranoid now. Okay. Let's continue on. Okay. So let's pick out a few more. There's a little boat here. Let's put that boat in. You know that the back end of it is kind of like a rectangular shape, and then you've got a kind of this roundish bit there, and it sort of goes around like that. There's something in here like that. There, I might just put something going up like that. So you have to have them on all of them. You know, smaller boat here. As I said, like as we keep going further back into the distance, we just want to reduce the size of everything down. Okay, reduce everything down so that we've got smaller objects. And the good thing is that you can actually put in a far less detail and just look at what's the simplest way you can get in a shape of something. Okay, and there's like another one here. You know, just have a bit of fun and think to yourself what type of composition you'd like. Okay, what else do we have here? We might have another boat here. Okay, I'm just gonna make a smaller one like this. There. It looks like a kind of speedboat or something. Right. Okay. A few more here out in the background. And the longer you spend, obviously, on the drawing, the more detailed the painting will look at the end. Okay. Even if you're drawing in pencil, I find that by adding in more details, spending more time planning it out and stuff like that, you're just going to have a more refined looking scene. But with that said, I like to do things a little bit quicker and try to get in the essence of a scene. Like I don't want a photographic representation of this. We're looking at quick ways that we can get in a kind of indication of what's going on. Okay. Now there is a bridge here, even though it's somewhere here in the background. I'm just going to draw it in. It's kind of like, there's a stone, looks like a stone wall or something there. And then we've got like a kind of an entrance to an underground, could be like a passage under like that. Okay, head down like that. I'm going to carry this bridge across. Okay, you notice the bridge sits on top of the water. So when we drew that line, that water line right here, that's where, that's why it's so important. We have the big shapes in, get the big shapes in, and then we'll get the small shapes in after, the little details. Okay, if you start big and you get those important bits in first, the rest will fall into place. Okay, let's get in a few more of these bits and pieces. Donna's asking, should this be drawn in black pen? It's up to you, Donna. This is a stylistic thing. I'm drawing in black pen for the style of this scene, but also so that it gives you a little bit more, you can see better on the camera, because often when I draw in pencil, I find that people struggle to see what I'm doing. So I think doing it like this is just a bit easier today for the scene, but you can do it in pencil as well, Donna. Okay, so yeah, just looking at this bridge, putting in a couple of these bits coming down into the water. Okay, there's a bit here that's kind of a bit too connected together there. Okay, in the water, there we go. And the bridge, something like this there. Not too detailed at all, okay? I'm gonna just etch in this mountain in the background real quickly. Okay, just where it sort of comes down a bit. Another thing you can do when you're looking at objects in the background, you can also, if you have different size pens, you can use a smaller nibbed pen, and that will just create lines that are a little less obvious, thinner lines. If you've got a pencil, like a mechanical pencil as well, if you've got different mechanical pencils, some that are just a little bit more thinner, have like a thinner lead or what have you on it, it accomplishes the same thing. Okay, just sort of pushes bits and pieces back into the distance. You know, that's another, what's this, could be like a boat or something, another bit here. Okay, something like that. So we've got a fair bit of detail in here already. I'm going to just start putting in some of the houses up in the mountains. Now, question is, there's a kind of road that just runs across here. Okay, don't worry all too much about these roads and stuff like that. I'm really just going to simplify that down. And what I want you to try to do is work on these houses. And perspective-wise, this is going to teach you as well how to judge the size of objects, the relative size of objects, which is basically, one of the fundamentals of perspective. The little boats there, they look little because they're further back. Same with these houses. So let's have a look. We'll make one. Let's get in one of this pen. Just get in a bit of this one here. Just a rectangle base like that. If you can draw a rectangle, you can draw whatever this is. Looks like a hotel or something there. Okay, let's draw a square here, a square, okay? And mistakes are often, they do cause people to get a bit worried at times, and especially I remember when I was starting out, I'd always, scrunch up that bit of paper and be like, I've stuffed it up, I've got to do it again. Learn to work with your mistakes and try to finish off a scene completely, even if it hasn't turned out the way, or it's not progressing in the way that you've intended to, because what that does is that it builds resilience, it keeps you going, and also builds your skills. Because when you start learning, there's no way that everything that you do, every little sketch or painting that you start off with, it's going to turn out in looking like a masterpiece. You know, you're still learning, and it's more important that you get that mileage in terms of drawing, that experience in. So that's why I really recommend to finish something off. That way you can actually look back at it, have a look at what you've done, and think, okay, I'm happy I finished it. Firstly, you get that satisfaction of finishing it, and secondly, you get all the practice that comes with it. Okay, and pushing through. So that's what I really, really recommend. And you know, people often ask, how do I become more confident? How do I get more confident to go looser, to just be confident in my painting? And confidence doesn't often come until you're competent in something. So, and the only way to gain competence is to practice. And it's just that awkward stage in the middle where you're drawing stuff and you're thinking, geez, that doesn't look like what I'm trying to draw. But having faith that one day, with enough practice, it will turn out well. And if you guys hang around to the end of this, workshop, I'm going to show you some of the paintings I did in 2014, and I think you guys will be very shocked. So, you know, I wasn't born with any ability to paint or draw or anything like that. I just learned it. And you guys can do that as well. It's just, it takes a long time. And a lot of, you might see tutorials and stuff and they might tell you it's easy, you know, you can do it in this amount of time. But actually for most people, it takes quite a long time. If you've not had especially too much experience in art, or maybe you've taken a bit of a hiatus or something from art, go easy on yourself, yeah? Well, I've already made about 10 mistakes in this whole thing. Maybe you might not be able to see it, but I've certainly made mistakes in here as well. But it's just about going through, giving it a crack. I always encourage people to try new scenes as well, okay? Different scenes of, it could be like, you know, something that you've not done before, mountains or I don't know. Because that will keep you feeling adventurous, trying new things. Some of you guys who have watched me for a while on YouTube and on Facebook will know that I do a whole bunch of different subjects, okay? And some better than others, okay? I'm trying to get more into animals, like learning to do animals. And also, animals are something I've avoided as well because I've just not done them very much. But it's something that I'm working on recently as well. So stepping out of your comfort zone and being okay with making mistakes, knowing that it's normal to make mistakes. It's part of the learning process. Okay. I mean, I'm sure, you know, painting is like anything. It's like you start a new job or something like that. There's no way you're going to turn up on your first day or even be okay after a few months and know what you're doing. In fact, I think painting is probably harder than most things I've had to learn, and I'm still learning. I don't know if I'll ever master it completely. I don't think that's the point. Try to enjoy the process. Try to enjoy just being in the moment of drawing and painting. And if you can do that, that's half the battle. Okay. Tina says, should we always do odd numbers of objects, even of even numbers? That's something I've heard before. Yeah, like some people have mentioned in composition to do odd numbers. If it's a very, it's a very obvious obvious sort of composition where there's maybe like two boats, one boat here, one boat here. I think that just looks, sometimes when things look too symmetrical, because in nature, obviously, there's symmetry in nature, but there's also a vast amount of asymmetry with mountains and where, the way that trees grow. And so if you have things that are just too perfect in place, sometimes it can be, I don't know, just a bit off-putting. So the spacing of objects as well, like, you know, these boats, like I'm not going to put them all on the same line. I'll put them, randomize them, some here, 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 you know, a bit more in the front. Stuff like that. So I hope that answers your question, Tina. Loretta says, I sketch mine in pencil. Yep, that's all good. You can sketch in pencil or pen. And Neil says, confidence comes from experience. Yes, it does. Yeah. And you just got to practice. You got to practice and be okay with making mistakes. Be okay with a painting at the end that you think, wow, I'm so happy that I've finished it. You know, it may not be the best thing that I've ever created, but I finished it, and be proud of that fact, and be and enjoy the process of it. Because if you enjoy something, it's only a matter of time before you get good at it, in my opinion. So some things you can't control. Exactly. Like, so you might say, oh, I want to get by 5 months, I want to get really good at doing this particular thing. It may not be up to you. You know, it may be, you know, it may just be determined by other factors, how quick you can learn, you know, whether you've got experience before in drawing. Maybe you've started, you've done acrylics before in the past. Some people can do it, learn faster than others if they've picked up another medium. Okay. So set yourself goals that are achievable. And it's something like, hey, I'm going to try to paint two things a week. And if you can paint two things a week, then you can pretty much gain that experience. But don't put pressure on yourself. Say, I want to be this good. I want to paint like this artist by 3 months. Because often that's something, that's a goal that you can't control. What you can control is how often you paint and what you paint and the techniques you practice. Okay. Vidya says not able to see the reference picture to print it out. We'll paste the link. We'll paste the link in the chats, Vidya, so you can download them from my website. Guys, we're nearly done with this drawing. Like, I want to keep it simple, okay? Just to show you, it's more just we've talked about so many topics today while I've been drawing this. I want to keep it a bit more. Don't want to spend too much time detailing. Now, the figures, we want to put some figures in here. So let's go ahead and add some in. Now, I think I might put one in here. Put a head of a person like here. Okay. Always start off with a kind of rectangular shape and then the body kind of like here. Okay. There's a leg. Leg here like that. Kind of walking into the scene perhaps there. Okay. And of course, just a little bit of a shadow maybe running towards that left-hand side. Again, the perspective down the front is very, very gentle. Okay, so I wouldn't say there's going to be a huge size difference between the figures. But what you don't want to do is, let's say what you want to do is basically make the figures, you know, you want to look at the boats and think, okay, I can't have a figure that's this big. If I draw a person's head up here, for example, it's going to be too big. So we're going to look at the size of the boat and think, well, how big is a person going to be sort of normally standing next to the boat? So I think maybe like around here, head, the body, that might even be a little bit too big as well. Something like that. Okay. Might have someone here sort of behind there doing something, kneeling down or whatever, checking out the back of it. You know, I might have a person here as well. There we go. And again, just simplifying the details of the body. Top of the top is just like a rectangle I make for the head. The body, rectangular shaped, but you can kind of go like a inverted triangle as well. And the legs, just two elongated triangles. Okay, this could be two people just walking along, having a bit of a stroll in the morning. Okay, this is right in the middle of the scene. I probably would have preferred to place them a little bit to the left, but I don't have enough space there. And then you might think, okay, I've got another figure here, but I'll just draw a little bit larger, perhaps, in the front. Okay. Legs, just perhaps one coming out the front and one coming out like that. Okay. Fantastic. So it's pretty straightforward in terms of the figures. Like, I'm not really trying to put in much detail or anything at all. Okay, but as you can see, already by putting in those people, it makes it look more interesting. Okay, so bits and pieces. Let me think, what else can we do? Maybe I'll put another one here. Put another person here. Maybe walking towards that right-hand side. Oops, there. There. Okay. There. Maybe this person's got like a bag or something here as well. Backpack, you know, like that. But that should really do it. Yeah, I think with all the other bits and pieces, I might, you know, sometimes these houses have tiny windows and stuff, so I can just go in and do something like this, just put in a few little windows. Again, you can do this as well afterwards with the watercolors, with the smaller brush. But it's just yeah, just a thing I want to give it a try now. I've forgotten to put this little bit of, I don't know what it is. It's like a passageway underneath the mountain, secret passageway. Let me know how you're going, guys, and if you're keeping up okay, and if you need any help, if you've got some questions, happy to answer. I think we're good with the drawing, okay? Normally with line and wash, I might spend a bit more time on the drawing, but even with pencil, this amount of drawing is probably the maximum you want to do for a loose watercolor painting. Some great comments in here. We've got Laurie saying it's important to finish even if you're not happy with it. That way you can push past your struggle and see where you are. Yep. All art is a process. Yeah, and people often think that somehow people separate art from other things that you learn and think that it's you got to be born with it, or you're either good at it or you're not. No, it's like it's just training. It's training yourself to recognize shapes, to draw, to use different techniques in painting. You know, of course, there are some artists that are super talented as children, but the ones that I know, definitely not. All had to learn just like us. So I'm going to go pick up a brush now, and you should be able to see my palette here on that right-hand side. I've got my palette here, so you can just put it there so that there's a bit of, see what I'm mixing up. Okay. Now it's all over the place here. There are colors and things like that in here, but, we're going to start off first by, I'm probably going to get in all the warm colors. Okay. I normally start off with the warm colors, especially with, scenes like this where we've got lots of water. So that I don't accidentally mix some green in there. So I've got some yellow ochre, which is like a dulled down yellow. You can also use a hansa yellow if you want, a bit of yellow ochre. And I've also got a bit of, this is a bit of buff titanium, which is basically, it's kind of like white. If you mix a little bit of white gouache into your yellows, that also gets that. So the amount of water that I'm using, I'd say I'm using about, because the color is very light, 50% water to 50% paint. Okay, don't go too dark. And it's going to be hard for you to go dark anyway with this paint. With lighter colors, yellows, what else is there? Oranges and stuff like that. It's very difficult to get in any, even if you use it straight from the tube. But use more water, I'd say, than paint, 50 to maybe 70% water. Okay, and I'm just going to bring this all the way across like this to the right hand side there. Okay, and later on, I'm probably going to re-wet this section a bit as well. Okay, it's just a bit of the yellow. I'm going to think, where else can I find maybe some of it, put some of it into the houses here in the back there, a bit here. Okay. A little bit here for this one, like that. Okay, we're just looking at all the warmer bits. I mean, even here, you can see there's like a bit of the sand, like all the way off in the distance there. You can barely see that, but it's somewhere in there. Put a bit of yellow in there, a bit of yellow, just a quick line there to indicate something. Okay, quick line here. It goes off to the shore, like that. It's a bit too vibrant. Just drop in a little bit of white to dull that down a bit. Okay. All we're doing here is putting in the light colors. Okay. We're not trying to get in any details. Just the light colors. Okay. This building is kind of like almost like a brownish red color. So I put in a little wash of that there. Look how light I'm going. Remember, use a lot more water than you're using paint. Okay. Fantastic. These other houses here are interesting because they're kind of just white, and I'm going to leave them white. I'll get the roof in with a bit of this gray. But apart from that, I'm really not going to touch them that much. Especially even with the boats, we'll cut around the boats as well and we get in some bits and pieces. But now's kind of a good time if you want to get in some light colors on some of the boats. This is what I do. I drop in a bit of, just drop in a bit of paint in some areas. You know, a lot of them are actually white anyway. As you see, I've forgotten to finish off this one here. Finish off this boat. Let's just finish it. Okay. This was something else in here. What did I have here? Something's just floating around in the water. Okay. Lisa's asking what size brush. So with the brush, I tend not to mention sizes all too much because it depends. If you look at the bit of paper that I'm using, it's pretty small. So you're not going to want to pick up something like this or something like this. Maybe even that. You could probably get away with that. But you want to use a brush that's large enough to get in a nice juicy wash over everything, but also small enough so that you can cut around and cut around the details a bit, okay? So you're using the largest brush you can, but allows you to just have just enough control in there, okay? Hope that makes sense. Okay, because all these light colors, it's all very loose and what have you, so there's not really too much we need to put in there. A little bit of green I'm going to use. I've got some pre-mixed green, but again, if you've got your primaries, just mix your primaries together. Just a bit of yellow and blue together. And what I want to do is really create a little bit more darkness in the background now. I've got some brown, a bit of like geothite brown as well, which I've just some pre-mixed stuff. But if as long as you've got some green, you've mixed up a bit of green, maybe a bit of... And just chucking a bit of blue in there as well to darken up some other bits and pieces in there, you're going to get this nice little effect. Okay, some of the shrubs as well are kind of, look at them, they're kind of lighter. So I'm mixed in a bit of yellow in some of the greens here, there. Just put in a bit lighter greens in here, like that. You just change it around so that you don't have the same green in there. That's what I mean. If you've just got your primaries and you mix up a green, you can add more blue to make the green darker, or you can add more yellow to make the green lighter and more vibrant. Okay, so green is what they call a convenience color, and it's just something that's manufacturers will pre-mix to make it easy for people so that you don't have to mix it yourself. But it's not necessary, yeah? If you can save yourself a bit of money and not buy them, it's fine as well. I have them because it's just quicker. It's just quicker at times. But especially if you're a beginner, it's not necessary. And I think also, like what I was saying before, having too many colors can be off-putting because you... are then just distracted or constantly by the choice. And often when you have too many variables in watercolors, there's lots of variables, right? You've got how wet the paper is, how much water you're using, what colors you're using, what time to go in. Notice here as well, I'm creating some soft edges, okay, by just touching on and to areas. I'm cutting around the rooftops. Leave the white in some of the houses as well. There you go. It's okay to leave a bit of white in there, like that. There. Let's have a look. These mountains here on the right-hand side, they're like pretty light because they're further in the background. And I'm going to add a bit of a bluish tinge to it. I've just got some ultramarine blue. See if I can just add a bit of bluish tinge there. Something like that. Okay. Try to push it back. I'm almost almost turn to like a turquoisey type color. Okay. Put a bit of stuff in here. This is wet on wet. An area is already wet, and then you pick up a bit of paint, just drop it in. So I'm just trying to create some textures of trees and stuff. You can do it here as well. Look at that. Just drop that in. That could be a tree. It could be a darker tree behind. Okay. Here. Like that. When you're going wet and wet, you just want to be careful with how much paint you're using as well, and make sure you don't put in too much water in there because it will start to perhaps bloom if you're not careful. there. But some of the most beautiful effects, I think, in watercolors comes from wet and wet. That's why I love watercolors so much, because you can just get some fascinating textures and colors and transitions that I think is not possible in any other medium. Okay, that's kind of done. Let's go up to the sky. I'm going to use cerulean blue, a light blue. And if you've got any other kind of blue, just use that, but water it down. Water it down so that it goes pretty light, okay? You want the sky to be the lightest, almost the lightest part of your painting, okay? So just go in and just drop it in like that. I've only used one brush this entire time, yeah? You don't need 100 different brushes. A bit there. Let's get in a bit more here. Gone too dark there, but that's all right. I'll just shift it around a bit. Okay, there. Around, cut around those mountains a bit. We'll leave a bit of white in areas too. That's okay. But yeah, the sky's got to be pretty light. Some parts may blend into the mountains and things like that, but we're all good. And you can also, if you've got a little tissue or something, you can dab off some paint to get some clouds in. You don't have to do it. You don't have to do it, but it's just something you can do. You can sort of just use the... For some reason, this paint doesn't lift off so well, but usually when you've got other paints, you can sort of dab on and lift off some cloud effects, but I'm going to have to just make do with not having too many clouds in this one. Okay. Great. That's dried off really quickly. I don't know why, but this cerulean blue that I'm using, just it dries so quickly. It's crazy. Donna's saying, can you pause a sec before the sky so we can catch up? Yep, no problem. I'll hang just a little bit here and maybe just fiddle around with some of this some of these trees and stuff here. Okay. Notice how the sky kind of blends in a little bit into the wash of the mountains. Okay. That's okay. Just let it. Because creating some sense of connection with the sky and the mountains and even the water below is super important. Notice some of these trees kind of stick out a bit of the mountains as well, like that. So while the sky is still slightly damp, that's what I'm doing. I'm just kind of trying to blur the edge of this, where the sky starts and where the mountains begin. Okay, you got dark bits and pieces in here. Okay, Tosha is asking, can you name the colors again, please? Yeah, so the colors, all manufacturers have their own proprietary colors and all that kind of stuff. I think the name of the colors is not so important, but rather whether that color is cool or it's a warm color. So I'm using a bit of green here, undersea green, which is basically just it's a premix green which granulates out. You can mix it if you've got. You can mix a nice green from a ultramarine blue, and maybe like a hansa yellow, or a yellow ochre as well. Okay. If you mix yellow ochre with ultramarine, it tends to produce a muted down green. So it depends what you're after. I'm not aiming for too much vibrancy in all this. What color is under the ultramarine on MTN at the moment? What color is under ultramarine? I'm not sure if I understand your question, Lisa. The sky here is cerulean blue. I love cerulean blue for skies. Cerulean blue and manganese blue as well is good. Yvette's asking, is undersea green Daniel Smith? Yes, it is. Yeah. They don't sponsor me or anything like that. It's just the green. I like this green because it granulates well. Okay. I'm obsessed with granulating colors. So those of you who my regular viewers will know, I just love granulation. And just the interesting effects that you get in here. The brown. Okay, the brown that I'm using is a brown called goethite, G-O-E-T-H-I-T-E. It's also a granulating brown. If you've got a raw umber or burnt umber, completely fine as well. It just granulates out a bit more, so that's why I like to use it. So there we go. We've got a bit, you know, a bit of mountainous region here. Just make another layer. Try to make another layer here in front. Wet and wet painting is just, I love wet and wet painting. It's amazing and allows you to, just get in some incredible transitions and textures. Now, I'm going to continue on to the next step now. Just color in this bridge a little bit. I'll put in some yellow ochre as well for maybe a bit of yellow ochre and burnt sienna for these, you know, what do you call them? These little stilts or whatever going into the... So normally these bridges there have like kind of some brownie looking stuff there. All right. So here comes the fun bit. Let's get in the water. And we really need to go quite dark with this water, guys. So I've got an ultramarine blue. Oops, I picked up too much. That's all right. Ultramarine blue. And I might mix it around with some of this purple, just a tiny bit of that purple. But mainly just ultramarine. And again, you can mix your purple if you've got blue and red, which is part of the primaries that I suggested before. You can mix up purple as well. So I'm just going through, and what the consistency of this, I'd say it's because ultramarine blue is a very dark color. Okay, I'd say there's about 50% water in here, but if with some other colors you've got to use a higher concentration of paint, for example with turquoise, or you're talking about things like sky color, cerulean blue. Okay, you're often using a higher concentration. And if you're kind of at this point here where you're like, okay, I wish I added a boat here, I wish I'd added one here, well, you know what, you can do that. There's one. Okay, maybe we want to put another one in here. Just cut around, do something like that, and you might have another boat. Okay. So don't let the drawing dictate how, the composition entirely. Change it around a bit. Just want to leave that sharper edge here in the background like that, where the water starts. So we're just cutting around and taking a bit of time here. There. Let's cut around these boats here. Here, and they kind of go, the water goes behind, as you can see, underneath the bridge. Water under the bridge. There. And it's important, guys, to cut around the boats. Leave the white on them, okay? Because most of these boats are white, and they're going to form a really nice contrast with the water once we're done. Constantly just trying to mix up a bit more of this blue. If you have the opportunity to just mix up a large amount of the blue and just, I think as a beginner, I can mix this up very easily. But as a beginner, if you've got the water here, which is all pretty much the same color, if you mix up a large amount of it so that you're ready, so that it's all, it's all ready, you don't have to stop and remix a bit if you run out of paint, it's going to make it a lot easier. So you normally just try to mix the amount of paint that you are anticipating to use, especially if it's a very large wash. Okay. In this scene, it's not so much of a big deal. Okay. Let's just get this in. I got a larger brush, actually. Doesn't matter. Okay. Carry this down like this. There. Some kind of boat here as well. There. And as we move further down, we'll notice near the sand and stuff like that, we're going to get a little bit of blending between the water and the sand. How are we going to do this? So I'm going to just pick up another brush. Octavia's asking, what colors did you use for the shore? So for the shore, I've used yellow ochre and a little bit of buff titanium, okay? Buff titanium, which is basically a white color. We've got a bit of white gouache that works too. Shinolin, how you going, Shinolin? Good to see you. One of my regular viewers as well. And Shinolin's asking, hey Darren, when you do the water, is the color lighter or darker when you get closer? Depends. In this scene, yeah, because we've got the sand here, and the sand is lighter, it kind of mixes around with the water a bit, and so you get this transition which is a bit lighter. Same if you've got waves, like little bits of foam and stuff like that here as well. But normally when I go up to the back, I like to make it a little bit softer. But yeah, it depends, really depends. Like here in the foreground, what I'll definitely do is just try to lighten it near the shore, but I'm going to keep it, try to keep the color quite consistent. Here in the back, kind of just looking at that reference photo. Okay. And I also like in this scene, I want to make the water a bit darker so that I can get some really obvious sails, like kind of just going through mass. I mean, just going through the scene and cutting through it. It just looks more interesting, I think, in my opinion. Stylistic thing again. Great. So what have we done there? I think I'd put in a bit of water here, a bit of wetness there. So yes, this area is already dried, remember, so we got to re-wet it kind of like that. So I want to create a softer transition between the water and the sand, and I'm just going to pick up a bit of this blue and just drop it in like that. Okay, that there, and you notice it kind of just blends a little bit better into the sand. Okay, and this was an issue I had when I started painting. It just turned everything green, so you got to be really careful to preserve those yellows. Having combination of coolness, cool colors and warm colors is so important. I'm going to show you something really interesting as well. How we get in little waves. Well, you pick up a bit of blue and a bit of brown, and that's going to create a really dark kind of blue. And just drop in some of that in here. It's just to create some wave-like effects, like that. Little bits here, like that. I don't want to overdo it. Okay, just little. Especially when you go out the back as well, remember the waves are going to be tiny. Little ripples there. Okay, but this just, for me, creates a bit more interest in the scene. So it's not all the same wash. We've got a bit of texture, but basically just some indications of some ripples so that the water looks like it's kind of moving a bit, right? And when you're doing this, you've got to just pick up paint that's got a bit more... you're basically using a thicker paint for this. Okay, which means using more paint versus water in the mix. Mixing is something I know a lot of you have asked about. So important. It's so important because if you go in there and you use too much water, it's going to cause a big bloom, right? That's how I'm able to achieve some little bit of wave-like effects there. Now, these people, these figures here as well, I thought let's just put in some colors. I might go into some, I don't know, some orange or something for this person here. Let's go with maybe some brown for this one here. Something like that, light color. You know, for these two, I might go, let's put in a bit of yellow or something here for this person here. A bit of orangey color there for that person. This person here, I mean, they already got a bit of color in them already. That's fine. The boats as well. Let's put in some, a little wash of blue here, just a light wash of blue. Okay. Like this. It's actually quite a vibrant blue, but I've not gotten that in as vibrant as I wanted to. That's okay. And if you use some pure, almost pure ultramarine, it's very, very vibrant like that. Just drop in a little bit. The bottom of this other boat is kind of like a turquoisey color. Okay, so I can just drop in a bit of that. Again, these colors, guys, are not really that necessary. I only have them here. The palette, but it's more important for you to, especially as a beginner, to try to reduce down the amount of variables you have, because otherwise it just becomes too overwhelming. So try to look at how light and how dark these colors are. The actual tone of those colors is more important. Tone meaning, yeah, how light and dark, how light and dark they are. And if you can get that right, that's way more important than the color you use. And that's the kind of the light bulb moment for me was when I stopped worrying about what color exactly I was using. I was more focusing on the tones. So at the moment, we're not even, we got to put in all the dark bits and pieces, okay? But we're almost there. We're really just getting in this wash, this basic wash of colors, okay? Now, the next step, the next step is we want to look at getting in all the mid-tones and the final dark tones. Okay, the shins around the house is killing the colors as it is just shine. Louise, shins around the house. I'm not sure what you mean. Righto. This is so glad you asked, because what I was trying to remember, if it is darker as I get further away or closer. Yeah, in this particular scene, like the water is pretty consistent all the way through, isn't it? So sometimes as well, like, you know, depends how it's photographed. Sometimes you see reflections in the water, so you get lighter reflections further out the back. But normally speaking, yeah, things as you move back, they do get lighter. Fantastic. Let's have a look. If you've seen the new Daniel Smith colors coming out, there is a blue that will also be perfect for water. I hope I can get a tube of it. Yeah, I haven't seen that one yet, V. I'll have a look at it. Been a while since I've actually gone shopping for paints. Okay, let's go ahead and continue on now. Okay, we believe it or not, maybe 80% done. Really, what I want to do now is look at all the dark colors. Really, just put in all the remaining dark colors and some finishing touches. Okay, for the the highlights. Put in a bit of, sometimes put in a bit of red for the heads as well. It helps to get a bit of color in. Now let's have a look around. I think I'll start right up the top here, and I'm going to pick up a bit of green, a bit of undersea green. And let's have a look at where I can maybe put in some darker shrubs and things like that. You know, here I think around the houses. Like that, I can just drop in a bit of extra paint there. But I don't want to get in, I don't want to darken everything. We want to leave some of that previous wash. And watercolors is all about layering and making sure that you've got the a good balance between light and dark colors. So notice I'm just sort of skipping through areas. Some areas I'm going to exaggerate a bit and get in a few more bits and pieces, but other areas I'm just going to leave. Okay, you can even mix a bit of blue in here too. Tiny bit of blue in there. There. Okay, a bit of blue and green. Blue and green will just make a darker green, really. Okay. Okay. What do we got here? Maybe some bits and pieces running down like this. Here. Move it around a bit. Side of the brush, this is interesting as well. If you use the side of your brush, just do this, you can get a bit of texture like that. Okay, just another technique you can use there. A few more questions. I think Vivian says, thank you for doing this demo, love seeing the artist's processes, really helps me with my art. Yeah, and I try to explain what's going through my head at the time. Often you'll find when you're watching a tutorial, guys, I mean, how often do you find an artist is telling you, hey, I'm just going to do this, I'm just going to pick up and I'm going to paint this boat, I'm going to add a tree here, but they don't really tell you what how they're mixing it and why they're doing it. So now I'm gonna tell you how and why. And I like to go through those things because those are the questions you often have as a beginner, the process and how you actually do it rather than what you're doing. So Donna's asking, how do you prevent one area from running into the other when they meet? Well, sometimes you want them to run, sometimes you don't. But if you really want to stop them running to each other, you just let that one area dry first, and then you go over and you add the second layer so that it doesn't mix. But I've allowed that kind of to mix around. Here I've got a sharp edge. Yeah. Okay, a bit of the water. I was trying to get it to be more, a bit more mixed around. Okay. So, yeah, that's basically what I was doing. Just going into the background, looking at some, you know, areas of darkness that I want to just put in there. Now, even in this bridge, yeah, there's something to be, I think, could be added in for the bridge, some of the colors. Not the colors, I mean, but just a bit of darkness on the these areas of the bridge here beneath, like that. Okay. Hit the water. Okay. Just one line is enough. Okay, just one little stroke like that. I mean, here as well, there's some darkness underneath in there. Something like that. A lot of the time, you're not going to even be able to tell what that is. Okay, but because it's so far in the background, one of the big things I recommend is don't go too dark and too detailed in the background, because that's going to draw too much attention to it. So the moment I start fiddling too much with the background and getting too obsessed with things there, I've got to tell myself to stop, because at the end of the day, we want balance. We don't want the background so detailed that the eye is just drawn straight there. You've got to make everything else match up a little bit, yeah? Good. I think that's all right for the background. I mean, there's a lot more I can do. Normally after these sessions as well, I might have a little bit of a play around and see what else I can add in. But having some, this is what I'm doing. I'm just basically adding in some little dark spots and trees and that kind of little thing there beneath. This is the bridge or something. Okay. Even here. I'm not even looking at what exactly I'm painting. I'm really just looking at the tone, how light or how dark it is. Okay. Something like that. Good. Let's get in some shadows for these figures. I'm going to get in a bit of darker paint here. Let's draw in a bit of the shadows. Okay, I'm just going to color a bit of darkness to that left-hand side. And this dark color, I've just basically mixed up gray. And you mix grays by combining all your primary colors together. You can also buy one that's called a... it's called neutral tint. I use that a lot as well, okay? And what this is gonna do, as you can see, it brings out the, the figure is not the best, but we will make do. It brings out the light on the sand. When you've got a contrasting color, like dark color like this, not only that, but underneath the boat, you can see there's actually a little, little slither of darkness underneath those boats. It gives indication to the lights in the scene. So a little bit like that. I mean, that's not the best shadow, but that will do. Okay. It only takes a few little strokes and you be surprised at what you can accomplish. Just a little bit like that. Okay. Sometimes I do it with the pen as well if I'm doing this pen and wash stuff. Here's a couple of legs. Moving towards that left-hand side, like that. Okay. Might add in a bit of lavender color for this sail here. Just a little bit of something like that. Okay. Good. Shadows. Join this one up, actually. That's better if I just join that up, I think. There. Okay. Sometimes you can add a bit of bits and pieces for the hair, like sometimes a bit of hair. Yeah, just a bit of hair. Drop that in, A little bit of hair. I'm not even worried about the color of that hair. It doesn't matter. Okay. You got shadow. See, it all runs in that same direction. Okay. Now, here comes the magic bit. I'm going to go grab a tube of gouache. And apologies, I've forgotten to include this as part of the materials in the email that I sent out, guys. So, white gouache, it's basically an opaque paint. If you've got, I don't know what else you could use. I know some artists use whiteout. You know that stuff that, you know, no one has it anymore, but use it to correct. You know how we used to use it to get rid of ink when you're writing and you put in the wrong letter? Yeah, it's kind of like that. A lot of artists use that, but I use this other stuff. It's just gouache, white gouache. It's opaque, so I can go over the top and get in indications of sails and stuff like that. Love this bit. It's good fun. It's kind of like a finishing off bit, and you can do things like, look, I'm going to add in a bit of a little bit of like warmth for some of these boats as well. Okay, when you've got warm colors, when you've got warm colors overlapping with or kind of bordering cool colors like here, one of the amazing things is that it just looks so, it just draws interest, draws attention, right? So I'm going to do it to all of them, but this is part of composition as well. Like, I want the eye to move throughout the whole thing, right? I don't want it to just be focused here. So maybe you'll be like, oh, there's shadows, there's a high contrast here, and then we'll go here, go back here, back there, looking at the bridge, then come back down. So there's a, creates a bit of movement, which I think is, you know, all good compositions tend to do that. They just have a, it makes you want to look around. So that's what I'm doing, just a bit of that there. But anyway, I'm getting sidetracked. We just get in a bit of this white gouache. Okay, maybe this white gouache. Yeah. And I'm getting it. It's really thick. There's just a little bit of water on the brush from before. You just wipe this off. It's all over the place. Okay, I'll probably do a big one first. Because if you look at these masks, they're actually, they're pretty light, yeah? So go down. Join that one up there. You can join this one. Oops. And there you go. Again, if you make a mistake, just continue on. And don't worry, yeah? Okay, just getting some running up. I hold the brush right at the top of the top as well of it, so then you get more of a spontaneous feel to it. Okay. Some of them you may not even put a big one, maybe something like that or that. Yeah. You can regain a bit of, if you've especially perhaps gone a bit overboard with what you've done before, you can just, with the water, maybe you've gone over some of the whites of the boats, you can actually go through and go over the top and recover some of that. Okay, so we've got bits and pieces. You can even start putting in little boats and things and bollards in the water. So you see any of these little bits and pieces here like that. Sort of connect them up with the boats here and there. Okay, all kind of different colors, aren't they? Some of them are orangey, but they're all kind of like lighter colors, and they contrast with the water because the water is, quite a darker blue sort of color, right? So I suppose they make them this color so that they're quite visible, yeah? But the great thing is that they also create a little bit of warmth, a little bit of interest here in the water, so that it's not all just, it's not all just blue the whole way through. We've got a few bits and pieces as well running through, creating interest. Let me get a bit of this rope maybe running across. It's hard to do. You're really just drawing. Really, you're just drawing with the brush, okay? And that's why drawing is so important. And I do some of these line and wash lessons like this because I think a lot of painters, when they start off learning how to paint, they forget one of the most important things, which is you also need to learn how to draw, because drawing is basically painting is an extension of drawing. Okay, Look at that. We're really almost there. I'm just looking where else we can add in a bit of detail and such. You know, sometimes these little trees and stuff in the distance, you might put in a bit of some detail there for the trees, the branches. Okay, not too much. Too much. Something like that. Art Seto says, so appreciate you showing the ink mixing as other video lessons most often don't. This is valuable for beginner like me. Yeah, I try to make sure when I do these sessions to give you guys the best value, because you're taking time out of your day to sit here and watch this. And, I want to make sure that you end up with something at least that you understand what's going on. Yeah. So, you often find that, when I was starting out learning as well, I often found that there was just a lack of more comprehensive material out there that really helps you to understand what's going on. Now here's something different I'm going to do. I might do like a little reflection of the masts. Okay. Not all of them, maybe just like some of this one here. I mean, normally the reflection is more visible on the ones closer. Okay. Just, in the background, you're not really going to see much. But you will see perhaps little things like that underneath the boat, like little reflections of the white parts. Okay. I don't know. I'm not going to overdo it. Just something like that. Often underneath the boats as well, you will find that there is a slightly darker area, okay, where it hits the water. So, and just darken that up. Just pick up a bit of gray off the palette or some whatever dark color you've got. Again, like I was telling you guys before, the color doesn't matter all that much. Rather, the tone, how light or how dark that color is, makes an enormous difference. So often people ask what color, but I'm a big fan of colors too, but when you're starting out, focus on tone. Put a few little birds in the sky, a couple here, one here. I put these little kind of V shapes in the sky like that. Okay. Sometimes the faster you do these scenes, get this magical kind of loose feeling, which I love. Here we go. Some of the birds, you know, that you have, you know, even some of these could be birds just coming through. They split up the bit of the background, a bit little birds. There's like little V's or something just running through the water. Oops. Okay. There. What have we got here? Anyway, I think this sand is okay. We'll just leave that. Oops. A bit excited sometimes, guys. Okay. I think we are just about done. With this one, but let me know if you guys have any questions. Let me know. Pretty quick little one, but I think I've covered a lot in here to help you guys, especially if you're new to painting, learning watercolors, to basically help you to progress a bit faster and learn the entire process. What's going on in my head? Because it's so important to understand what I'm doing in my head. So. Let me just bring this over. I'm just going to have a look at the chats. If you guys have any questions, look, would you guys at the end of the day, like, would you like to feel, I know you've had a lot of fun in this session, but would you like to feel confident to paint any landscapes? I'm talking about like boat landscape, it could be a natural landscape, it could be a street scene. Would you like to feel confident to paint any landscape and learn a bit more about depth, creating loose paintings? So let me know in the chats anyone who's keen to learn a little bit more. I want to talk a bit about a program that I have running up. And let me just bring this up. Okay. Oops. I think it's not loading. Oh no. Let me just have a look. I think you guys can see it now. Here we go. So this is the new program that I have running, guys, and I've you know, for those of you who have watched me for some time on YouTube and Facebook, you would know that I do a lot of these lessons for free because I love doing it. But one of my dreams is I want to teach full time. I want to do this as a living. So I'd like to introduce to you the Watercolour Mentorship Program. And this program is basically a fundamentals course. So it's an in-depth program. We learn the fundamentals of drawing in relation to painting, talk more about perspective, watercolor, go through brush techniques, layering, and basically a lot of the questionnaires that I've asked you guys to fill out. That helps me run these workshops, the free ones that I run every week, and also some of the more in-depth courses that I have. And you know, some of you notice I talk a lot about the process of painting and constructing a scene. Because that's what painting is. It's essentially a process. If you can understand each part, you end up with a beautiful painting. But sometimes if you're missing just a small part, if you're missing the drawing aspect and you're not sure where to put the horizon line, the painting's going to turn out funny because you haven't got those fundamentals in there. So again, repeating myself, but I go by the name Watercolour Mentor. It's just a name that I started off you know, naming myself in the beginning. Because I basically want to, I know that all of you guys have the potential to create a beautiful painting, okay? It's not something that you're born with, okay? And everyone has the ability to create a beautiful painting, hang on your wall, show off, but show your friends and families. So I think though sometimes when you're starting out, you do need someone to help bring out that potential in you. So I'm going to go through what's included in the session, in my new program. Just checking if everything's come up okay. I think it's okay. Yep. So we've got 4 weekends. Okay, and I am starting next weekend on the 19th. I've got the times here as well at the bottom. So in the first week, we're going to be talking basically a lot about techniques and theories. So I'm going to go more in depth into the actual construction, how I plan out a painting, how I decide where to put objects, talk about depth, talk just a lot more in depth as to what we're going. But to give you guys the fundamentals and simplify this down a little bit more, we'll maybe even do a project that's a bit more simple as well, because I really want to focus on those fundamental techniques and theory, because I think if you get those basics in and then we apply that to a short project, we have like a painting where it applies those skills, you're going to be in a much better position to know how to apply that to any other scene, any other kind of landscape. So second week, we're going to go through some advanced techniques, another short project. So talk more about things like wet into wet, maybe some scratching out techniques, just some tricks that I've picked up over the years that really speed up your learning and make sure that you get a fantastic painting by the end of it. And in the third and fourth week, we'll have an advanced project. So the fourth week, I'm going to do a 3-hour masterclass. Now, each of these sessions, they run for 2 hours, these first 3 weeks, but I'm not actually concerned if we go over. I think I'm quite happy to go over as long as it gets you those results. So just put 2 hours, because I know for some, for a lot of people, 2 hours is quite enough. So often what I like to do is take like a break in between and then continue on. Okay. But at the end of the day, the goal for me is to make sure that you end up with those results and that you understand what you're doing, because there's nothing worse than you're painting and you just have no idea what color you're using, what you're mixing, what, you know, you've got an idea, you can see the painting that you want to produce in the end, but you're not sure how to get there. So I'll walk you through the entire thing to make it easy for you, and we'll repeat that and repeat it, and you'll find that there's the same process that you can apply for every painting, you know, as we've kind of talked and touched on today, and it will really, really help you. So we'll also go through a bit about mindset. So a bit about positivity, resilience, pushing through mistakes. Talked a bit about that today, and building confidence as well. So often people don't realize how much mindset actually determines how your painting turns out, the outcomes. So Really interested in self-development myself, and I've got an honors degree in psychology. So I use some of that knowledge to help motivate people and give you some tips on how to persevere through things. Because when you're starting off, I always see people just give up too easily. And, you know, as you can see, I might go to the next slide in a moment, but you can see some of my paintings that I've done back in 2014. Okay. But like I said, how often do you see in a lot of tutorials where the artist will go through and they'll show you what to do? They'll be like, okay, I'm putting in a bit of paint here, a bit here, but they're not actually telling you how and why. So that's one of the things I really like to do. And I do have a teaching background as well. So really try to keep in mind what you guys need and explain what I'm doing, because sometimes it's obvious to me, but it may not be obvious to you guys. So I like to always look at the chats, read and see what you guys are needing, and then adapt and provide that assistance to you. Because often the things that I do for granted, I don't realize, geez, that took me 3 months to learn. Fantastic. So next. So it's as part of this program as well, I've included some special course. Now, it's a course that I made specifically for this program. It's an 11-hour course. It's pre-recorded on top of, this is on top of the live workshops that we're going to have every week. Okay, so 11-hour course, 30 chapters on how to paint loose landscapes. So it covers so many topics, creating depth, understanding perspective, learning brush techniques, water control. I've talked about a lot of these things today, but I go into more detail in this course. There's 11 projects as well. And the whole aim of it is just to make you feel more confident in planning your painting, okay? Here's the projects as well. I've just taken a bit of a, made a little slide here so that you can see what's included, okay? These took me maybe about an hour, just over an hour to do each one, okay? So you can certainly get there as well if you give yourself a time limit on each layer that you're putting through it, and also that you know, if you know what you're doing, understand the process, you become a lot more confident. Bonus, I thought I'd include a few bonuses to make it as valuable as possible. Often when I have been making classes and other courses for a while, and I always try to include as many projects and stuff that I can to make it make sure that you guys have a lot of choices and value. So I will review your paintings as well as part of the course. So you can, one of the good things about getting feedback is that you can, you basically just get some tailored tips and direction as to where to go next. Because sometimes when you're a beginner, you're looking at your paintings, but you don't really know what you've done well or what you could have done better. And it's very difficult. Sometimes you think that looks good, but you're not sure why. So I'll be able to look at it from an experienced perspective. So you kind of get a see into my mind, and I'll give you some feedback to help you progress faster. So got a few other bonuses to as well. So there's this other one here, which I've got 6 video projects. I think it's 7 hours. I had a look at the content, 7 hours of content. So I go through the drawing and the painting for each of these 6 scenes. And I've got New York here. I've got a New York scene. I've got Croatia. Of course, I had to include a couple in Melbourne. I'm living in Melbourne, and I'm actually from Perth originally, but I've moved to Melbourne. I just had to include a couple of those. And thank you. I think someone might have sent, I can't see who, but thank you. Someone sent a donation. We've got Venice as well and Burano. Okay, so you can have a look. These are some of the projects here. So they deal with different types of scenes and situations. Okay, I've chosen these specifically so that you can practice street scenes, you can practice a night scene, you can know how to draw a complex landscape and paint it in line and wash, kind of like we did today. Here's a few others as well. Now, how often is it when you, I don't know, has anyone done a course before? Let me know if you've done a program. Sue's asking, I would love that. Do you think it can be a Zoom class? It's is, I'll have to look at it. I was basically going to be doing it basically a stream similar to this, where you guys can chat. But what I'll do is that I'm thinking of perhaps making a separate chat room where you guys can speak and talk to me as well. So I'll have to look at that. But yeah, so no one's done a live class. Okay, sounds like no one's done one. Yeah. Normally, like I've done quite a few. I purchased courses myself on the internet for whole different topics, like making website, for example. I've done courses and stuff. Often what you find is after a course, what happens? I mean, you basically are left high and dry. It's very hard to get any more help. And sometimes you lose that momentum. You're going through, you're doing the course is great. And then you're kind of left thinking, what do I do now? So I've created a private group, basically, where you guys can gain assistance post-course. So I'll basically be going through, answering questions, stuff like that. My patrons also have access to this group. There's two other groups that I'm mainly known by. There's Watercolour Mentor Community, which has, I think, 2,000 plus members, and there's another one called Watercolour Beginners, which has nearly 130,000 members, which are also available. It's so important to get feedback from different people, not just myself, but from other artists. This group is more tailored towards this program, only available for people in this program, so that I can give you specific feedback and answer your questions, things like that. But I mean, generally having groups and being part of them keeps you motivated, keeps you progressing. Okay, so you can post, show your work, get a bit of feedback, help other people out, that kind of thing. The last little bonus that I thought I'd throw in is I would also like to include 40 of my pre-recorded courses, so access to 40 of them for 2 months. So these are all my courses, everything that I've made over 2 years, I'd say. There's 40 classes in there, a lot of content. I've said there's 200 hours here, but there's actually, I think there's probably maybe 350 hours. I haven't checked it lately. I teach on different platforms, and I really want to have my own thing going along. It's just easier if I run it myself, and I can run things my own way. Whereas when I run on other platforms, there's rules and things like that. But these are some of the ratings that I have. As you can see, that's like a 5 rating on Facebook, and mine's a host rating. And then I've got this other one here, which is pretty high as well. So got like a few thousand students on some of these platforms. So here's some of the projects that are included in the course. And if you end up signing up, which the link is in the description, by the way, you also you'll provide your email address as well. And that is what I'll use to grant you access to all these courses. Okay, so there's two there. There we go. So these are just some of the projects. As you know, I do some portraits as well as line and wash, normal paintings, normal watercolor paintings as well. So how much does it cost? I've not actually prepared this properly. Oops, I think I've lost the screen. Yeah, so basically we've got $400 of value for the 4 live workshops, okay? They're going to be two to 3 hours each. And $100, which is what the actual 11-hour course is priced at. Got another $60 of value there for the 6 watercolor video projects that are included. $100 of value for the student support and the private group access. Another $80 of value, and then $60 of value for the access to the 240 courses. Okay, so that's a lot that you get in there, and certainly you're gonna be, you're certainly gonna be, busy for at least 3-4 months. There's a lot of content that will keep you busy, even in between these live workshops. So, normal price, it's the value of it is $800. Normal price is basically what I was be charging for it, usually is $300. But it's my first launch. As you can see, I'm not probably the best at presenting all these bits and pieces and things like that. So in terms of this little pitch that I have, but for the first time I'm doing this, I just want to offer that for $197. That's including tax. Okay, and again, the main thing is that I want to help you to feel more confident in your painting and be able to look forward to painting and enjoy it, feel that you're good at it, be able to show your friends and family, have it hanging on your wall and be proud of it, and just stop a bit of that frustration you get just not knowing what to do. And I have a unique way of teaching. I do talk a lot, but I really like to explain what I'm doing, and people find that quite helpful in terms of knowing my process. I think more information as I'm doing something as well. It took me a while to figure out, to get comfortable doing that, because it's quite difficult, I think, for most instructors to talk and explain everything they're doing while they're doing the painting. So that's something that I've learned to do. So in terms of the how to enroll, if you check in the description of the scene, of the, not the scene, the video, I've got a link to the class, okay? So check it out and enroll now. I'll just paste the link down, but let me know who's interested. If you're interested in joining this course, just type enroll in the chats and I will send you the link. I'll also answer some questions from you guys as well. So let me know if you have any questions in the meanwhile. On this program, or if you have any other general questions that you want me to go through in terms of watercolors, but let me know if you're interested. Terry's asking, can you do this class by Zoom? I'll have to check, Terry. I was gonna do it by YouTube, but that's the aim at the moment, to do it by YouTube and be able to access by just access support by chatting to me. Though I can also include another chat room and a Discord chat room where you guys can join and talk to me through basically like a call, like a group call. So if that helps, I can definitely look into that, Terry. But check it out. It's in the video description, and if you're interested, just type enroll and I will send you the link. I've been preparing the content for it for quite some time as well. So just going through what I'll be running each week, with an idea of the projects, looking at some of the things that you guys want to cover as well. So obviously depth, creating, layering, some of the mindset stuff, which is important as well. So when we're talking about, persisting in your painting, working through mistakes, how to make the best of a mistake, and even just rephrasing what the idea of a mistake is. Sometimes it's just a thing that happens, and you gotta, and sometimes it works out better. Even when you make a mistake, funny enough, you end up with a more interesting painting by the end of it. So that's about it. I've got, that's the enrollment page. If you check it out again in the description, it's all available there. Kate says enroll. Fantastic, Kate. I'll just send you the link. It'll be great to see some of you guys in this, and, I'm really excited to actually go through everything more detail, and because it's going to be not more of a smaller class as well, I'm going to be able to focus on your individual questions. Also slow down a bit too, I think. So just mainly tailor it to the group that's there. Let me know if you have any more questions. I think it's a there's a lot of content in there. Like I mentioned before, you got your core lessons, which is basically a lot of these live workshops. You get four live workshops, 2 to 3 hours each week. I'm going to be running them at the same time as today. So 6 to 8 for those guys in the States. For Melbourne, that's for me, that's 10 to 12. Get access to that. So Lisa's asking how many, so it's basically, I have like, I don't want to have too many enrollments. So it's basically, it'll be a smaller class, but it'll be more tailored towards you guys. Okay. So, I want to get more into teaching and basically expand out a bit that way. So, but I don't want to have enormous classes and stuff like that. Peggy says enroll. Fantastic, Peggy. I'll just send you the I'll send you the link, and also Lisa, I'll send it to you as well. Okay. But keep in mind that I've taught classes of over 100 people at a time. Okay, so used to handling large crowds, but with these sessions, I really want to make it a little bit more private and a little bit more tailored to your individual needs. And so that's why, you know, I'm going to offer you as well. You know, you can contact me through Messenger, you can contact me through the group and send me your paintings and ask me. Something that I already do, to be honest. I mean, people message me, my phone is always going off, people messaging me, sending me their paintings, asking me for tips and stuff. And I try my best to get back to everyone. I love to just share, love to share what I know. But as I said, I would like one day, it's my dream to do this full time. So it's always good to try new things. So I thought I'd try this out and give you guys the opportunity as well. And Renee says, will there be a recording if anyone misses a class? Yeah. So everything is recorded. So if you on that sign up page, if you check in the description, the enrollment, basically that will bring you, once you enroll and then everything like that, you have access to the 11 hour course or the projects. And I'll also add your email to access the 40 classes. And each week, these videos will be posted up after it finishes. So if you're not available then, you can go ahead and watch after. And if you're not sure, if you want me to explain through something and you were not able to make some of these sessions, I can actually go through afterwards and give you a bit of a hand. Just message me, and if you have any further questions and stuff like that, I'll do my best to answer some of your questions. But I find a lot of people, even when they watch these workshops that I do, they're pre-recorded because I talk a lot and I go through so much. It tends to be, I don't get all too many questions here and there. So but certainly you're available to contact afterwards. So again, I'll just quickly go through what's included. You get the 4 weeks, 2 to 3 hours, 2 to 3 hours of live class with me. Okay, 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on a Saturday. That's for you guys in the States. I have to convert it over for Melbourne again. Saturday, this is Sunday, 10 a.m. for those of you in Melbourne. You get, as part of the core lessons, 30 chapter course. Okay, goes through everything you need to know on how to create a loose landscape. Okay, I'll go through so many different topics as well. Some different projects, I mean, so there's 11 projects, and so there's a lot of material. Even there, you can get started doing that one straight away. If you enroll now, you have access to that right away. And of course, the bonuses again, which I'll just talk about. And I think I talked about some of these. This is what I started off painting at. So, you know, this was back in 2014, and this is something that I did recently here at the bottom. So certainly, you know, I think it can be hard sometimes to, you know, I can definitely relate to where you guys are coming from, because I was in a place where I just had no idea what I was doing. And I'd have a look at, watch hundreds of tutorials, and a lot of them will be speed paints, or, even if they had, someone talking at it, it'd just be pretty brief, or it wasn't detailed enough for me to understand what was going on, because I'm a very process driven person. I'd like to break things down into small bite-sized chunks and connect them together, and that way things are a lot more simple than you actually think. So again, that's the bonus, including the review of your paintings. You've got these 6 awesome projects that you can start on straight away. It's a 7 hours of content. I'll go through the drawing process of each of these scenes, the drawing process and the painting, what I'm doing as well. So nocturne scenes, these night scenes are something that are quite popular as well. People like to see them. I haven't done too many of them. I've done a few of them, but I go through the process of how I do those as well. As you can see, my style is very loose, but I also go through like some more detailed bits and pieces. As you can see, you know, I think I showed you some portraiture before. If you can build your technical skills up to a certain point, which is what I'm going to help you to do, if you can build your technical skills up to that certain point, then basically loosening up is just making that process a bit more efficient. So you're painting, but instead of taking 100 brush strokes to get to a certain point, you might only take 5 to 10 to get in an impression of the scene. A lot of people think loosening up is just, I'll just pick up a bit of paint and move it around and hope for the best. But loose painting actually requires a lot of thought, because every brush stroke matters in that sort of style. You can see it in like oils as well, the kind of alla prima style, where artists really have, it's just, I love that expressiveness that you get with the efficiency of brush strokes and the confidence of knowing, hey, okay, I'm going to do this cell. I've done this 1,000 times before, like that. And being able to work faster is a byproduct of just knowing what to do, because you know what the next step is. You know how you're going to do it, so you can speed it up. But when you're not sure, it's very hard to create looseness and fluidity in your paintings, because you're still learning as you're going. So I will help walk you through that, and basically provide you with some one-on-one assistance as well. So again, you know, here's the group. Access to the group. There's whoever for the program, and also my patrons on there. Not all of them have joined. I posted it on my Patreon, but they I think some of them have not seen the post or what have you. So it's on there. Again, really, really good value in terms of the 40 courses you get access to. There's so much content on there. I'd really be surprised if anyone even made it through half of it. You'd be painting like every day, so a few hours. So a lot in there, especially if you guys want to learn a bit of portraiture as well. You can see I've got some portraits in here. I go through my process on that simple method on how to paint portraits. So a lot of content in this. So check out the enrollment if anyone is interested. Let me know in the comments. Terry's signed up as well, I think. Thank you, and I'll see you soon, Terry. You should have access to the you should have access straight away to all the content inside, the pre-recorded stuff. If you need help, guys, if you're logged into the course and you're wondering where stuff is, I've made it pretty simple to find it. But if you if you're struggling, message me. You can message me on my page, Darren Year Art. You can message me in the private group, which I've put in there as well. Many different ways, and I'll get back to you. Cynthia says, I find loose painting very difficult. Yeah, it's deceivingly difficult, because artists often make it look like it's so simple. And they often say it's simple, but it's not. It's only simple because they're confident with their techniques. They know what to do, what to put in. This one's pretty loose as well. This one I did, this is one of, was suggested by one of my patrons, V, and she wanted to do a kind of Christmassy type scene. Oops, actually can't see it. Let me just disappear, get rid of this for a little bit. Still figuring out how to use this thing. Here we go. There we go. So that scene here, it's a pretty loose sort of scene, right? And it looks like you could just whip this out in 15 minutes or 20 minutes, and everything's just, all the paints just fold and fell in the right places. But it takes a little bit of planning to actually do that. few more comments here. Sue says, sounds wonderful, but I'm sorry, can't do it this time. Hopefully next time around. Yep. So I don't plan on doing these all too often because it's going to be, you know, fair bit of preparation for me each week. It's going to be a lot of fun. But I just want to give you the opportunity for those of you who want a bit more and want to progress faster and get some more tailored support. And basically would be interested, just enroll. And it goes a long way for me as well, because I love doing what I do. It's great fun, and being able to just share that with you guys, and just being able to paint and draw and paint, and is such a magical thing. It's got me through some really difficult periods in my life, where I've gone through just dramas in my family, breakups, that kind of thing. And you just pull out your sketchbook and you can create some beautiful paintings. Okay, so there's a lot of mental health benefits, I think, to painting. And I think it's, a lot of people just think it's just creating a pretty picture, and there's that, but it can take you so far. And even just my art in itself has been able to bring people together in a community. I think that's been so helpful and so amazing for the last couple of years. Louise is asking, can you do afterpay? I'm not sure. I don't know if I have that system, but Louise, I can do like some kind of payment plan if that's easier for you. I can do some kind of payment plan. If you message me on my page, I'll just reply to you and I'll send you my page. Okay. And then what you can do is just send me a message there and we can work something out that works for you. Laura says the timing isn't good for me. Laura, you've signed up for another class. Will you be offering this again in another few months? Yeah, I will be. So this is the first time that I've offered this. So normally I've just done, I've done a lot of that pre-recorded courses and stuff. So this is the first time that I am doing a more live tailored workshop for small groups. So Marion says enroll. Thank you, Marion. I'm just going to send you the link so that you can put in your details, and make sure as well when you enroll, use the email address, your current email address or whatever the one that you use the most, because I'm going to use that email address to grant you access to the 40 courses that I have for 2 months, so you can jump in there and go ahead. And V is asking, could I convert 2 months of my unused patron to the course? Yes you can, V. I will I'll send you the link. I'll send you the link afterwards. I'll figure out how to do it and send you the link. But I'd love to see you there as well. So V's one of my private students, and I think I've been away for a little bit. I was a bit worried about you actually, but good to hear you're going okay. We can convert some of your unused patron for sure. Great. Laura says, great. Love your teaching style. So if I can get into your program in a few months, that would be fantastic. Yeah. I'd love to see you there too, Laura. So, if the timing's not working out for you this time around, don't worry about it. We can, fit you in next time. But, I just don't know when I'm going to be running the next one. I'm planning to take a trip in May. Things have been a bit, busy later on throughout the year, so we'll see how we go. But if I am running one later, I'd love to see you there. I'm just having a look to see if there's any other chats. We've got a let's have a look. Carol says, thank you for your generous sharing of your art and knowledge. Thank you, Carolyn. for coming along. I had lots of fun. As you can see, I'm just multitasking a lot as well. I'm looking at this other screen to just check the comments. Sue says, sounds wonderful. Can't do it at this time. Hopefully next time around. Yep. Thank you, Sue. And thank you for coming along. Really appreciate it. Tom says, thank you, Darren. Enjoyed your workshop. Thank you for doing it. You're welcome, Tom. Thanks for joining. And, you know, I think you guys are on my email list as well. So you should be able to see on my, I'll send out emails and stuff. I do other free content and things like that too. So I send out some of that stuff. So if you want to keep in touch with me and know about upcoming workshops and stuff like that, I'll continue contacting you guys as well. Let's have a look. A few more comments. Lisa says, this was great work on my lobster boats. Thanks. Thank you, Lisa. So Louise says, earlier when I wrote about the shine on the painting, it was from the light shining on wet paint. So all we could see was a bright shining spot. Oh, damn, yeah. Sometimes I've got to move that light around. I've got to move it off into the back a little bit so that it avoids that. Sorry about that, Louise. But good to let me know. Let's have a look who we got. Laura. Covered off on quite a few different topics today. You know, guys, let me know as well. You know, if you've done any other courses, some of your experiences around there, and how you found the workshop today. I would really like to know how you found it. I do my best to really, I don't know. It's a lot of time I don't even process when I'm painting, I'll just say exactly what I'm doing. So it may come off with a lot of words and stuff, but I think for you guys, when you're learning it, it makes a big difference. Okay. Artists are normally very introverted people, and I'd say I'm maybe in the middle, or maybe a little bit more introverted, but certainly, as you can see, I can talk a lot if I want to. Let me just have a look and see if there's any more chats. I'm just going to make sure if there's any more questions and stuff like that. I get back to all of you. For those of you who have enrolled, I am really looking forward to the session next week. So, really keen to get started. The feedback that I also got from you guys, I always use the surveys and stuff to make sure that I take on board what you guys want to see. So let's have a look at the chats. We've got Yvette. Yvette Paul says, a great opportunity. Would love to do it later. Fantastic, Yvette. Maggie, I think we'll have a look here. Yeah, Yvette, if you, at some later stage, you can always join. Yvette is a friend of mine and a viewer who's been watching me paint for quite some time. So, Yvette, you've been a really great support to me, and reach out if you need any help and stuff like that too. Always happy to be there, answer questions and stuff like that. And so it's really good to see, Yvette, how far you've come as well by being so consistent with your painting. You've learned a lot through these workshops, but you've got to the point where you're exhibiting your art, which is absolutely incredible. And I'm always so happy when you send me a photograph of a show that you've entered, and it's just wonderful. It feels one of the most rewarding things I've ever done in my life, I'd say. Just running these sessions and being able to see people grow and advance. Shifting my head around. Let me have a look. Shift my head around. Maggie says, sent you a private message. Okay, I'll have a look at it I'll have a look at it later, Maggie. Yvette says, workshop today was great. Enjoyed the subject. Fantastic. Don says, I enjoy hearing your thought process as you paint. Wonderful session. Thank you, Don. Initially I was a bit worried. Perhaps I talk too much, but I think people find it helpful that I do explain a lot. It does take a while for me to kind of process things as well, because I have to think to myself, how did I do that? So it helps me too. V says, I love today's workshop. I enjoyed every bit of it and was able to catch up on missing the very beginning. Thank you. V says, glad it contained water as I'm painting every day, trying to master water paintings. Yeah, so scenes with water in it. I love water scenes, things with boats, contrast between water and sand, beach scenes. I think beach scenes are a great place to start off for beginners. So it's actually what I'm thinking of doing for the first week. But again, with the projects, you know, it's also something I've got a plan for each of the 4 weeks. But if there's something that you particularly want to paint, let me know as well. Let me know as well, and I'll take that into account. Okay, but I the reason why I've pre-chosen some subjects is because I want to make sure that you get a variety of subjects that are different to paint, because we often, when we're painting, we choose subjects that we are most comfortable with. We also choose subjects that we love to look at the most, but often we choose subjects that we're most comfortable with. And with comfort, we often don't push ourselves outside our comfort zone and learn things that are new. So I want to make this challenging for you at times, and so we'll try different things, okay? Fantastic. V says, Pamela says, bye. May do this next time. Have to finish the one I'm doing. Fantastic. Yeah, Pamela is one of my students in one of my other programs. So I think you're doing the loose painting one at the moment. So fantastic. And I saw your beach painting the other day, which was really cool. So keep in touch, Pamela. And if you need more help, just let me know. He says, I would love to learn while painting beach/lakes or anything water with reflections of skies, trees, etc. Just magical. Yeah, I'm obsessed with reflections and contrasts of light and dark, shadows, stuff like that. It's amazing how just a little shadow can take your painting to the next level. And these kind of sharp contrasts like this, they can often be quite scary for beginners to do, because you think it's so dark and it sticks out so much. But it's really necessary. Once it all dries and comes together, you realize that it's just part of this whole scene. It's part of indicating that light source on the right, something which I'll talk a bit more about as well, light sources. But it's not too difficult to understand light sources. It's just basically, you know, picturing the sun in the part of the painting, part of the scene, like up here, and then making all the shadows run in the direction that's consistent. So there's so much to consider, and there's only so much that I can go through in each of these little workshops. So I love to see you there. If you're interested, type in role. I'll send you the link. Even if you just want to take a look at it, you can take a look at it and decide for yourself. But really looking forward to it. Marion says, thank you so much. Really enjoyed this. And look forward to your course, Darren. Fantastic, Marion. And I'm looking forward to seeing you there as well. And glad to have you. So Artcito says, thank you. I enjoyed this and will take you up on lessons in the future. Fantastic. Thank you for coming along, Artcito. I'm glad you got something out of this workshop. And I hope to see you. I hope to see you in the next course that I run. But for those of you here and you're kind of on the fence, you're not sure, should I do it, should I not? You know, look, think about it this way. it's like a weekly sort of thing. It's like a weekly sort of thing. We're catching up every week, and I'm making sure that you're progressing each week. So I give you feedback on your work. Each of the lessons are going to be, the live lessons are going to be done from a very process point of view. So like, I'll explain everything from the start to finish. You see me draw, plan things out where I place objects. That's what makes such a big difference. When you have someone that's really been through what you've gone through from the start, you know, painting from very simple stuff, just beginning to learn, which is what I've done all the way up to now. I've taken classes, I've taken all types of things, and I know basically what works and what doesn't when I'm learning. So, you know, I like to get feedback from people as well, and as to how you know, things that they'd like to understand, and that's how I've kind of figured over time. It's a lot of things that the instructors, teachers don't really talk about enough, and assume that it's knowledge for the students. So that's why I always ask myself, when I say something, when I'm doing something, I try to explain how am I doing it and why am I doing it. And if I can do that, and if I can transfer that knowledge to you guys, that process is something that I apply to everything. So everything I paint turns out at least okay. Not everything's a masterpiece, but I understand how to place the objects. I understand how to get in shadows. I pick a light source. I understand how to create depth by layering. I understand how to paint water, how to paint skies, how to draw things so that they appear larger and smaller and creating perspective. So a lot in there. Let me have a look. What else have we got here? Just let me look who else we got. So B says, yes, me too, but I'm struggling often getting the reflections and transitions. Yeah, it's timing in watercolor. Timing in watercolor is yet another thing that is tricky, because when we're talking about timing, we're talking about how when to go into a certain area. So this part here, for example, you know, it was kind of wet before, and then it dried off. So if I had just put in the water layer just at the same time that I did the sand, the water would go straight in, especially if I went really dark, it would go straight in and blend into the water, creating a bit of a mess. So I kind of let it dry off a little bit, re-wet that area, and then encouraged it to blend. So same with the water here, these little ripples. You notice I've just put in little lines here and there, okay? And the little lines create a bit of depth in that water, a bit of interest. And it's not so sharp because it's wet into wet. So the time that you actually go in with that brush is so crucial. So watercolors is one of those mediums. It's not like it's not like acrylics, not like oils, where you're just often taking your time. It doesn't matter, because oils especially take so long to dry. I used to paint in oils when I was I think about 18, 19, and you could just sit there a whole day and it just won't dry even. So with watercolors, there's something magical about it. There's that sense of urgency, it's excitement. You're getting it all done, and it's designed to be loose and expressive. I know a lot of artists, they go in with let me just have a look. Can I get some questions here? B says, cannot see the screen. It is showing the lessons again and rolling our screen. You need to close it again. Could you pointing at? Oh, sorry, guys. Let me just go back into that. Got too excited and I forgot what I was doing. Got to close the window. Okay. So what was I talking about again? Just talking about the water here and the timing of the water. You can see how that's got a furry edge. This little wave here that I put in, a little bit of a furry edge. And the sail, the mast, it's sharp edge. Okay. It's a matter of timing, because here this area of the wash was already wet. So when I go in there and I put in a bit of water, a bit of paint, it spreads slightly, okay? But you don't want to put it in just as soon as that area is wet. You kind of want to let it dry a little bit and then you drop it in. Because if it's too wet, this will just spread out and be a mess. So timing is so important. And the getting in these sharp bits there, that's when everything's dried off. And then I can put in some sharp bits in there. So that creates a bit of contrast and it avoids all that white making a mess. Timing is something I think that a lot of beginners struggle with. Because you don't realize this area of this is water. If you put something dry in there, it's just going to spread and cause a mess. So you kind of got to be patient at times. Just wait till things to dry at some points. Paint what you can. You can also paint what you can wet into wet. Okay. Fantastic. I'm just having a look. Yeah. Yeah. I had the screen up. It's okay. Again, guys, if you're interested, have a look at the enrollments. What's it? Dr. Lynn Ryan says, Darren, could you please ensure the enrolled. Oh, sorry. That's all good. And Lynn, great. We've still got about a few people in here. Guys, if you have questions, let me know. I'm very happy to answer your questions, whether it be about the scene that we did today, any general watercolor questions, or if you want to know a bit about the upcoming course as well. It's good to see we've got a few people signed up for next week, and I'm very excited to see you there. Let me have a look let me just check the chats if we have other questions and things like that. Excellent. I think Jenny's as well. Thank you, Jenny. You've sent me a message. I'll make sure I'll use your other email address to send you out those courses. When I give you access to the 40 courses for 2 months, you receive another email. Okay, because I have another membership site, Buy Me a Coffee membership site, and I can give you a couple months of access on there. So check an email that says buy me a coffee, and it will have it'll be from me, and it will have your details in there for you to log in to access all those courses in there. Okay, so I'll get onto that just after I finish up today. And the great thing is that you guys are going to be able to access it straight after. Going to be able to log in. If you enroll now, just be able to log in and access it straight away. So. Claire says, I have to go, but I sent a private message about enrolling. Thank you for the tutorial today. It was my first time doing watercolor and it was great to have your guidance. Thank you, Claire. I'll check your my messages afterwards. And again, like some of you guys are on the fence and you want to know a bit more about it, or just want to have a chat to me in general, feel free to drop a message, okay? We'll see whether it's right for you, and go from there, okay? There's happy to answer your questions. It's all good fun for me. And Peggy says, looking forward to the link. Yep, I'll send it down. Keep an eye on your emails, Peggy, in the next hour or so. Next couple of hours, I'm gonna go on and give you the 2 months access. But if you for those of you who have enrolled in the program, if you need more, if you can't find the link or you're having some technical troubles and stuff like that, reach out to me. I'll get back to you. Great. V says, I'm excited about the course and I'm so happy you have designed it. I know I've I will finally learn what I need from you to begin painting better. I so badly want to do plein air. Plein air is fantastic. I'm glad to have you part of the course as well, V. And I think in a smaller group context, we'll be able to definitely move at a more slower pace and can tailor things better as well. So as you can see, like, I've done a lot of these workshops with, you know, hundreds of people in them, but obviously it's going to be probably more tailored and more personalized, this one. Okay. B says, have to go. Please email Darren about joining. Thank you and good night to all. And I hope to see you all there. Fantastic. Thank you, V. And I will catch you there. Have a good night. Don says, I love traveling the world with your sketching painting sessions. I looked this one up. Falmouth Harbour, Wales. Yeah, I didn't know where this one was, Don. I was looking because I downloaded this photo, I don't know, it was like 4 or 5 months ago or something, and I was wondering where is this place, and I ended up doing a reverse image search, and it's Falmouth in Wales, so it's pretty cool. So Dr. Lynn Ryan says, thanks Darren, I have enrolled, it looks good. Suggestion, give prices in Australian and US dollars. Okay. Thank you, Lynn. For some reason, the platform that I use only allows you to display one. I think probably in the slideshow, I will just add it in Australian dollars as well. I don't know what the conversion rate is. I think it's like probably be another $50-$60 on top. But thank you for the suggestion, Lynn. And I'm looking forward. Really looking forward to seeing you there. It's going to be good. Going to be good fun. Lots of value for you guys. Great. Let's have a look. And checking if there's any more questions. Any more questions here? We've got Anne says, that was a while ago, actually. Don't worry about that. So we've got Terry, and got Lynn. We've got a few people. This is going to be good. Natalie's joining as well. Guys, if you have any questions, let me know. If you want to have a think about it as well. Again, I'll be starting next week at the same time, the first session. Okay. And for those of you enrolled already, I will also add the materials to each session. So you can check in the videos. I'll actually add into my platform as well. The videos, the materials that you will need, because I want to do a combination, get you guys to do a combination of both just normal watercolors and line and wash watercolors, okay? Because if we have a combination of them, that's going to basically put you out of your comfort zone a little bit, but the line and wash is going to help you to build your drawing skills, okay? And I draw straight on with my pen, but at times, you know, when you're starting out, you can use pencil, go over the top with pen, or you can just leave it with pencil and just do it in pure watercolors. It's a different look, as you can tell, with if you've got pure watercolors, something like this, the edges a lot more subtle. Still see the pencil showing through, but the edges are a little bit more subtle and you get more softness and areas and things like that. Whereas with line and wash, you can really see the details of all the buildings and stuff like that. It's kind of like creating your own coloring books. Okay. Let me see if there's any other examples I've got. You know, that's a beach scene I did the other day. This one here, I think I've included. That's in Bhutan. So a little bit more subtle. with the edges, as you can see, some of these trees coming up around the edges as well. These are sharper, okay, but you're not going to get as much sharpness as you get with this, so good to try different ones, and at some point you'll discover and you'll find what you like best, what kind of style you like best, and particular subjects that draw you in a bit more. So fantastic. Elisa says, would you be able to put up the photo so we can download it? Yes. Yeah, so Lisa, I'll send you a link. I'll send you a link for the reference, is you can just download it from my website. Okay. And that way, yeah, you can access it there. So and Lisa says, let me just have a look. Lisa says, sorry can't make session this time. Saturday evening time isn't best. Yeah. I had a look at the, because I did a bit of a survey, and Saturday evenings or mornings for you guys work the best, and I just ended up picking one because I think evenings, mornings for you guys, I'll be asleep. So yeah, I figure that you guys can, most of you can seem to make this time, so stick with that. And also based on the survey. Fantastic. Let's have a look what else we have. I think we are all good. I'll be ending the stream soon, so if you have any questions and anything else you want to talk about while I'm here, just pop it in the chats. I'm happy to answer your questions. Just pull out a few other sketch. This is another sketchbook that I have. Put something up on the screen to look at. You know, some of these worked out better than others. Some of the sketches. Okay, that's another line and wash sketch. That's another one of the Rialto Market in Venice. So. The great thing about line and wash is you could be doing some traveling, you could be out and about, you can just pull out your pen and just start sketching and not worry too much about accuracy and everything like that. And I'll get a nice little, beautiful little impression of what's going on. Lisa's saying, is gouache China white paint? Gouache is basically opaque watercolor, so it's got chalk in it, I think. Yeah, so it's got chalk in it. I used really good video equipment as well, guys, so for those who have enrolled in the course, I can do stuff, cool stuff like this, where I can really zoom in, focus, and that way you can see all the little details, little things that I'm doing here. You can see the reflections, the little gouache brush strokes like that. So when you look really close, it looks a bit messy and everything, but then when you zoom back out, it looks okay. So it's often painting is a bit of an illusion. You're kind of just making it seem like there's more detail in there when there's not. And indicating, I always like the idea of indicating rather than stating everything exactly, because here's another little scene that I did. This was one of Melbourne, I think. Who was it? Yvonne, one of my viewers, Yvonne Ulmer, she suggested to do a scene of Melbourne. So this was something that I drew and painted the other day. So with the week four and week three and week four projects, we're going to do some complicated stuff, and we're going to really push your comfort zone, because if you know the process of being able to draw and paint something like this, I mean, even if it's not as detailed, then you can pretty much draw and paint anything. So you will notice and you'll find out soon enough that there's basically process that you just repeat. It's not a magic. It's no magic thing that I'm going to tell you and suddenly you're going to be excellent overnight. It's the process that I follow, and just being consistent as well. Okay, so I'll help guide you in that right direction. And Lisa says, those ships are lovely. Thank you, Lisa. I really like that one. And this was funny because I really rushed this one. I think I did this in, I don't know, I think I did this in less than an hour. But as, you know, these windows, they drove me up the wall, just getting in these windows. It was really, really annoying. But, you know, it turned out well, especially I like this reflection on the boat here at the bottom. And if you can, maybe just move that a bit. I'm going to get rid of this, get rid of that reference like that. There we go. Yeah. So, see that little reflection there, tiny little sharp waves. Okay. We didn't do many sharp waves in our demonstration today, but combining sharp waves with soft waves is a great little technique. This one kind of has both. You got some soft ones here in the background, but most of them are sharp, as you can see. Okay. This reflection, having combinations of cool and warm colors in there as well. Asking to go right. Do you want to see these ones, dear? Have a look. These ones are not as detailed, but you know, they kind of, again, from a distance they look like something, but when you go closer, you realize how simple they are actually to draw. But again, it takes understanding of composition and training to train your eyes to recognize objects as shapes, not objects, but basically things like boats, buildings, people. Looking at them and finding shapes in them and then drawing those shapes. And if you draw the shape and you paint the shape and the tone rather than looking at it as a boat, it ends up looking like a boat at the end. But if you try to draw a boat, sometimes it doesn't look like one. It's really weird. Other painting side page, Lisa's saying. Other painting side page. I'm not sure which one. Oh, you mean this one. Sorry. Okay, there we go. It's a quick one. Quick little loose scene, right? I think this took me like 15 minutes or so to do. 15, 30 minutes. Just shows how simple something can be. But some of them didn't work out so well too. Not all of them work out. This is these are some scenes that were suggested by one of my patrons, Ellen Whitney, and she wanted a scene of Vegas, and you know what this is? I think I did like a city scene. This is Tokyo, I think. So, let me see, what else have we got in here? I think I did some flowers. I've got some flowers in here somewhere. There you go. There's some flowers. Having sketchbooks, using sketchbooks are fantastic because you can really learn so much and you can pull it out. This is a sketchbook that I made myself as well. So you pull it out, no need to tape down paper, none of that. You can just get started straight away. That one didn't take very long as well. Another street scene, couple of little street scenes. And for those of you who like traveling, you know, they're great because you can sit down, have a bit of a rest, do a quick little sketch, be on your way. And then when you get back from your holiday, you've got this little book of memories. I mean, I find when you paint or draw something that you, a scene that means something to you, or it really consolidates that memory. And then you've got something to look back and remember when you're done. So that's something I like doing with my holiday photos. I pull out the camera and take some pictures and... have a look. What else do we have in here? All kinds of things. I think that's really it for this one. Okay. Thank you, Louise. And yeah, Louise, if you want to message me, I think you might have a question, just let me know. I'll get back to you. I think that's it. I don't think we've got any more any more questions. If you liked the video today and you got some benefit out of this class, please share it around with your friends. It helps helps me to reach more people, and they can also access this this free workshop today, get to know me a bit, get know me a bit more as well. It's so ironic, it's so funny as an artist that you tend to, I realize now I spend so much time like just sending out my the videos and things like that, so marketing and things like that, but you know, if some of you watching want to help me out and you enjoyed the session, yeah, feel free to share it, like the video. That really really makes a big difference for me. So alrighty, I think we're all good. For those of you who are still around, thanks for hanging around to the end. I hope you've not fallen asleep on your computers. Thank you for joining. Really appreciate you being here and learning, and I'm glad to be able to help. I'm gonna go grab some lunch now. I'm getting hungry. So for those of you who are enrolled, again, I'll use the email addresses that you've enrolled in, but I think someone, I think Jenny sent me another email address, so I'll enroll that one in the 40 courses, okay? And Tracy says, dang, did I miss it? Yeah, you've just missed it, Tracy. It's, you can rewind the video though, you can have a look. You can have a look. I think did I send you the notification for it? I think, some people may have missed out on the notification. I wonder if some of you got the messenger, because I use some messenger program to send out reminders to everyone prior to the session starting. So for those of you who are watching afterwards, if you're watching afterwards and you're just having a look, you can still enroll. Okay, I'm going to be taking enrollments the entire next week. Okay. So if you want to think about it, or maybe you're watching this video after, you can still enroll. It starts on, for you guys in the States, it will start on, 19 March, for you guys in the States. Okay. Which is actually a day behind Australia. It's, always have to keep that in mind. Fantastic. Thank you, Maggie. For those in Australia, so in Melbourne, so it's Melbourne at the moment, it's the 13th of March at 10 a.m. will be when the sessions will be starting, okay? So Vivian says, this art paper can use back and front. Yes, you can, yeah. So this, with 300 GSM paper, because of the sizing on it, the water doesn't soak through, so you can use both sides. I think that's one of the great things about using a bit of thicker paper. It gives you a bit more control as well, so that the paper doesn't just warp around everywhere when you're painting on thinner paper. Tracy says, I'm in Australia, Perth. I'm from Perth originally, Tracy, so... I can't remember what the time, probably is like a few hours time difference, hey? I don't remember what the time difference is from Melbourne to Perth. It'd be probably a few hours. But it'd still be, if you're interested in enrolling in this program, it'd still be at a time, I assume, that will be reasonable for you. Whereabouts in Perth, Tracy? I was living in North Perth. Yeah, I was living in North Perth before I moved over. It's been a while since I've been back, since the borders have been closed as well. Been meaning to visit some of my friends over there. They've been asking what I've been up to and stuff. Donna says, is paying the price for 100% cotton paper really worth it for a beginner? Because I sure throw away a lot of attempts. 100% yes, Donna. If you can afford to get some cotton paper, it really makes a difference. And I'll tell you why, because even if you don't end up creating masterpiece, okay, if it's just something it didn't work out, you get the experience of painting on that paper, because as you build your skills as an artist, what you find is that you become limited by your materials. and you want to layer more, you want to change this, or you want to get this effect, and suddenly the paper that you're using, it doesn't work. It doesn't allow you to really express everything that you want to express. So the cotton watercolor paper I find to be the best, it's like the gold standard of watercolor paper. But with that said, just use the best materials that you can afford. I mean, I started out, I just used cellulose paper. I don't even know what paper it was. It was just basic paper that I had lying around the house, cartridge paper even. Okay, you don't need cotton paper, but I'm just saying cotton paper is, there's just some magical things you can do in it. And you have better drying time. The colors appear way more vibrant. It just gives you so many options. So one of the things you don't want to be limited by is your materials as an artist. If you're serious about progressing and getting better at your craft, you want to try these other materials that the professional artists are using. Because as I said, there's a limitation. There's a certain point where the materials that you're using, if you're using a cartridge paper or something like that, or some watercolor paints just from the shop, down the road, maybe they're like, you know, a $5 thing of watercolor paints, which I used in the beginning. They'll serve a purpose as you start, but I always recommend getting the best stuff you can afford. East Fremantle, Gracie. Oh, cool, Fremantle. I miss Fremantle. Such a, in fact, like those, Fremantle will be a really good coastal sort of scene as well. I remember there's like a jetty there, and there was like a statue at the end of the jetty near the Kalis brothers, and then Joe's Fish Shack, I think, behind it. But there was some kind of jetty, and sometimes there's a one of those tour boats around there. And I just remember that so clearly, with seagulls flying everywhere. It's quite amazing. It's been a while. I miss Fremantle because I don't really get to see. I don't really get to see too much water and stuff around here. Oh, Bon Scott. That's right. Yeah, that's the statue. Statue of him there. Yeah, I think he's final. Yeah, it's AC/DC. Yeah, are you an AC/DC fan, Tracy? I play guitar. Well, nowadays I don't play that much, but when I was initially learning, and I think AC/DC is one of the classic classics that you always try to learn. You know, Thunderstruck. See a lot of beginner guitarists trying to play that and butchering it, which I did at the time as well. Tracy says, we'd love to see more of your work. Have a look. I've got more videos and stuff on my channel, and I'm in Melbourne. I live in city in Melbourne. So I wanted something a little bit different from Perth. I just got a bit. Yeah, I just wanted to try something different. So I moved over here. My family's over here as well, so it makes sense. I used to play guitar as well. Cool. It's a cool instrument. It's a good instrument. Alrighty. We've still got a few people on YouTube watching. I think that's about it. Guys, I'm going to end this one. But thank you all for coming along, okay? If you want to see more videos, more tutorials and stuff like that, follow me on my pages. You can check them out. I'm on social media and stuff. So you can go to Darren Yeo Art, or you can search for Watercolor Mentor. And of course, I've also got a website, watercolormentor.com. And there's more resources and stuff like that there. And I hope to see you all next time. Thank you. And I'll stop the stream.